invocation by Mr. Ross and the Pledge of Allegiance led by Mr. Benton.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, Lord. We are gathered here together in your name. We pray that you would bless this board and with wisdom for Spotsylvania County, that you would bless and protect all of our residents, and that for the United States of America as well, that you'd give us all wisdom in the upcoming election, and that it would be for your glory. We pray for your peace. We pray for your forgiveness. We thank you for the sacrifice of your Son and your grace and your mercy for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty.
I believe the consent agenda is first.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, if I may have the floor computer, please. Today's consent agenda is very short, and it's about to get shorter. The first item is approval of the board meeting minutes from October 11, 2016. But board members, I ask your forgiveness. I'm going to request that we pull that item and bring it back at your next meeting. There's been a small detail issue that's been raised that I need to verify. And so there just simply was not time to catch that issue this afternoon, and we will have to bring that item back. So please, let's strike item one. Item two is the approval of the Rappahannock Area Health District annual funding agreement for our local health department. This money operates our local health department. It's $633,426 in state funds that are matched and supplemented with $647,569 in local funds, and I have verified those numbers. Those are the budgeted numbers for this fiscal year. Next is the acceptance and a budget adjustment for the FY17 Edward Byrne Justice Assistance Grant Award. This is to provide the drug naloxone to our law enforcement agency. There is no local match. Naloxone is a life-saving drug used in the treatment of overdose cases. And item four is a business license refund. It's a routine matter of a refund to MediaBridge LLC in the amount of $4,054.47. And so it's just items two, three, and four that are here for your approval on tonight's consent agenda.
Does anyone wish to pull any of the remaining items from the consent agenda?
Motion approved.
Call the question.
Six yes with Mr. McLaughlin not present.
And now I understand we have a photo op, but we may need a different photographer because our usual photographer is to be in the picture.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. I've asked Sheila from the County Attorney's Office if she would volunteer service to photograph the board with our own Kathy Smith. Our PIO is retiring at the end of this month. This is Kathy's last meeting with us, and I think a picture with the board would be most appropriate. If you would please step down to the front of the dais. Next, we do have public presentations. Nikki, has anyone signed up for public presentations?
Yes. Alfred King, followed by Richard Toy.
Okay, let me run through the guidelines. Public presentations, please briefly. Public presentations are an opportunity for citizens to present matters you believe deserve the board's attention. These presentations are not part of a public hearing. Sign up to speak at each public hearing is separate. Public presentations are one-way comments from you to the Board of Supervisors. This is not a forum for dialogue or debate. To make a public presentation, please sign up on the provided sign-up sheet and print clearly for us. Come to the lectern when your name is called. Clearly state your name, address, and voting district for our record. Address your comments directly to the board. State whether you are speaking on your own behalf, in which case you'll have 3 minutes to speak, or speaking on behalf of a group, in which case you'll have 5 minutes to speak. Public presentations shall not be used to address matters subject to public hearings or to make political campaign speeches, private advertisements, or personal attacks. And as always, the community's written comments are welcome. Thank you.
Alfred King.
Alfred King, 11102 Fawn Lake Parkway, Livingston District. I am representing a group, but probably won't take all 5 minutes. I'm here to talk about the library budget, which I understand was pulled from today's agenda. I think it's fair to say that your board is not supposed to be bound by prior boards. A prior board signed a contract with the regional library that called for certain contributions based on usage. The county has not provided its actual share for the last couple of years, and the library board has received a lot of criticism from the other members of the group, specifically Fredericksburg, Stafford, and Westmoreland. They are insisting that services be reduced in Spotsylvania if you do not approve the funding. The county owns the Snow and Salem Church branches, so you could disassociate the county from the regional library. In my judgment, that would provide less service to our citizens and more cost. Or if you kept the same dollars that you've appropriated for the regional library, you would get far less service for our citizens. So this is a decision that you people have to make. I just want to read something that one of my friends sent to me. My son, and this is a friend, my son mentioned to me that his friends, all Spotsylvania County high school graduates and Virginia colleges, were together and they began to discuss about the Spotsy supervisors not supporting and fully funding the county's share for the libraries. The friends were critical of the board's inaction. This group of friends are smart kids, all honor graduates, Eagle Scouts, and so forth. Frankly, they were embarrassed for their county's behavior. I think it is interesting that this issue is being discussed even with the younger generation. I do not understand the timing of your decision, why you pulled it, why you didn't pull it. But I think that it's fair to say that if at the next meeting, you're going to have one more opportunity, I guess, in early November. If it is not approved, then I am reasonably confident that services will be immediately cut at the two branches. Thank you.
Richard Toy.
My name is Richard Toy, and I'm from the Cortland District. And Mr. Chairman, I'm here to ask that full funding be given to the library as they had requested. The library is looked at by some as just a building that houses books. I personally think it's more than that. Realistically, it is among other activities and just as great as other activities we have in Spotsylvania County. Benjamin Franklin, Thomas Jefferson, John Harvard of Harvard University, donated books and money to support libraries in their communities. I'm merely pointing out that great learned men saw the value of libraries. Some may take the library for granted. However, from my perspective, the library is an institution. It is an institution for learning. It is a treasure trove that has been discovered by an untold number of Spotsylvania County patrons. The key to this treasure is simply a library key, a card. Mr. Chairman, today I celebrate my 90th birthday. Some years ago, had I attempted to get in the library in Virginia, I would have been jailed. Today, things are different. I read Mr. King's piece in the Freelance Star, and I totally agree with it. But I want to add a little personal kind of thing in addition to what he wrote in the paper. I use the library quite often, as many other people in Spotsylvania do. America's former First Lady, Laura Bush, described the library as palaces of the people. I agree with that. In addition to what Mr. King wrote in the paper, and as I stated earlier, the library is a gathering place. It is a community center. It is used by moms and dads who take their preschoolers to various storytelling programs. It is used by students K through 12 and beyond. It is used by individuals who simply want a good book to read. It is used by those who do scholarly research. Meeting rooms are available for use by the community organizations and civic groups. I myself use those rooms. Several daily newspapers are available. Untold numbers of periodicals are there for use. Computers are available for those who do not have them at home. And yes, let's not forget the delivery service that visits the Lee Hill area and the far distant rural areas of Berkeley and Livingston to serve those people who do not have a library within a reasonable distance. Mr. Chairman, and under the members of this board, I ask that when you deliberate to decide funding, that you give serious consideration to the value of the library, just as Messrs. Franklin, Jefferson, and Harvard did. Full funding for the library is an asset. It is one that pays dividends. Thank you for the opportunity.
No one else.
Is there anyone who did not speak who would wish, who did not sign up, who wishes to at this time?
Mary Lou Collier, Mr. Skinner's district. I am most grateful as a citizen of the county that the board has approved the grant for the police department to administer naloxone to those that come in contact with drugs, and their life is maybe not going to be a life anymore if it is not administered. Same way with our fire and rescue personnel as well. I'm not going to tell you my age, but I'm just grateful that I have not been involved in drugs, but drugs have no barriers. It affects all age groups, men and women, children. It's sad that somebody goes down that road and doesn't know the good choices, and maybe they don't know where they can go to get help. My question is, what is the next step once the drug is administered to these victims? What kind of help are they getting? I just wish that more money can be provided to provide services to mend these people. And I only offer that instead of drugs, look to God as your source. Thank you.
Is there anyone else who wishes to speak at this time? If not, we'll close the public presentation time. We have board reports next. Mr. Skinner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Speaking about the library, just so the public realizes, the night that the library came here and discussed this with us the very first time, supposedly there was a letter in our package that night that I didn't see until after I got home. So I want the public to know that, first of all, I support the library very much. I think the library is one of the most important things, especially for those children who don't have the ability to have a computer at home or have the internet in their area and such of that. I would say that I would like to see the library have some type of control over the computers as far as playing games and stuff of that nature on it. I think it's very important for it to be used in the proper manner. But I do support the library, and I support it. I support in giving it the money that it needs to. So I will be voting for any type of, well, to catch up for the 100, I believe it was 124,000, close to it. So when we do that, it's my objective is to give them the money. But on the other hand, I think it's very important, as we lose Al King on the board, that I think it's very important to have someone in a supervising position on that board. Perhaps it'll make a difference, but it'll be easier to communicate with us. And for that reason, what I'd like to do is, and I know that I'd like to nominate Mr. Ross for that board, the CRL board, and because I know he shares many of the ideas that I do about the library. I know he knows the importance of the library as I do. So it would be my motion to nominate Mr. Ross as a the member to follow up with Mr. King's position.
So motion on the floor. Is there any discussion? Mr. Jakubowski.
Thank you. Thanks, Mr. Skinner. I do have interest from somebody in my district about this position, and I didn't realize that we were going to make a motion tonight to put somebody on the board. I figured we would do it at the full discussion. That's actually part of my board report, was to ask whether or not we wanted to have a board member or not, or if we wanted to continue along. I don't mind having that discussion. I would just ask that, could we put this to the November meeting? Is that a problem? Is there a meeting coming up where we need it?
I'd have to ask, is anybody from the library, Mr. King? When would be the next meeting that whoever we send as a representative, when is the next meeting of the library of the CRRL? Could you come to the podium, please? Thank you, sir.
Ordinarily, it would be on the second Monday in November, but I think that if the benefit to all concerned would be to have a board member from Spotsylvania County as a representative, that the board might be very willing to postpone the date until after your next board meeting, which I think is the second Tuesday of the month. So technically, the library board would be before your next board meeting, but I think that beneficial to everybody to have a board member on the board, and they'll change the meeting.
Sir, did you say the second Monday in November?
Yes, I think so.
The second Monday in November would be the 14th, which is after your next meeting, which is on the 10th.
Mr. Chair?
It's just probably the way that, it's probably just the way
okay.
The week.
Okay.
So no problem. Thank you, Mr. King. I appreciate it. Yeah.
Mr. Ross?
Yeah, I did talk with Mr. McLaughlin, and so I think we should just talk about whether we should have a board member on or not tonight.
No, I would recommend, too, that Mr. Let's not vote on this until we get to Mr. If you don't mind, Mr.
He fully supported, and I don't want to speak, I'm speaking for him, but he fully supported a board member being on, and he fully supported your nomination of myself. So I think if, as far as what Mr. Jakubowski brought up, deciding whether, discussing whether it be a board member or best to have a citizen, maybe we can just have that discussion now. I don't see anything holding us back.
I would like to have that discussion prior to a vote, then, please, Mr. Chair, or Vice.
Anyone else who wishes to discuss that issue? Mr. Bent.
I'd support a board member.
I think I would, too.
Okay, thank you for the discussion. That's all.
So, I didn't mean to put that that way, but, you know, I personally really think it's important so that we stay out of this situation where this funding, you know, like I said, this was a real surprise to me, to be honest, as far as what they said to us. The letter was in the package as far as the cut in service and everything. And if it is true, before I go on, I do want to recollect that there are other counties out there that did not always pay. If you take a look at back at the history, that there are some counties out there that haven't made their full. And so all I ask is this, is that the board make sure that they put as much equal pressure on them or take services away from them. Is what I'm saying is, let's just make it equal. I mean, I support the library very much, okay? But I went back and we saw a presentation where it showed other counties not paying their full, and are they receiving the same thing, saying, hey, we're going to cut your service? Okay, well, let me ask you something. My problem is with us, the two major libraries are in Spotsylvania County. And so if we get cut, everybody gets cut. So you won't. So what you'll do is, you know, and this is probably something that someone can explain to me.
We will have... we'll have further data, and that was really why the item is not on your agenda this evening. We were assembling some additional information. We did not have it all, could not get it all together in time for today's meeting. We'll have that for you on the 10th, and it'll be hopefully clear at that point. We'll be able to answer your questions.
Okay. Well, I appreciate that very much. But so in that case, I'll just ask that the motion go through. Yeah.
And Mr. Chair, if I might, I just want to say I've been using CRR libraries since 2000, so the year 2000, first in Stafford County, and they're just an incredible asset to our community, our regional community. It's where underprivileged children can go and privileged children can go. Story time, book reading time. I fully support the libraries. Mr. King's letter, what Mr. Toy just said, they are something that I consider the government should be involved in. There's some things that we're involved in and that have been before this board, which I'm like, why is this even being considered a government function? But the libraries certainly are, as well as the sheriff's department and fire department and schools. So I fully am going to be supporting or fully funding them this year, whether it's ongoing money or one-time money. I think that's something that we need to work out. And so I wanted to make sure all the board members understood my position on it going in. I'm not going to be going over there to cut funding by any means, but to be our representative, be our voice. And the Salem Church Library is in the Cortland District. It's the busiest library in CRRL, and it's the district I represent. So I would appreciate your vote and your confidence. Thank you.
Mr. Spiel? Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. King, could you come to the mic for a second? I'm calling you forward because I wasn't prepared to discuss or act upon this tonight, and I'm looking for some information. How often are your meetings for the library board?
Roughly four a year.
Four a year?
Yes.
And they entail the discussion of budget and so forth.
If you give me 1 minute, I'll describe what happens. The staff provides us statistics of the usage of the library. They provide us an analysis of the current budget position of actual expenditures versus anticipated expenditures. The board in the last year selected the new director and in effect monitors the performance of the staff. Since we have a very good staff, we don't get very many complaints, but there are occasional complaints which are brought to our attention, and it's the board's responsibility to answer those on behalf of the library as opposed to putting the finger on the specific director of the library.
Thank you very much.
May I make one other comment?
Sure.
I've been on the board for 8 years. Stafford has always had one of their board members, board supervised members. The city of Fredericksburg has always had one of their members. Westmoreland, frankly, is a pretty small part of the library, so they only have one member on our board, and it's not a particularly vital interest. But Spotsylvania has been notably absent, and it really helps the discussion when board of supervisor members speak on behalf of their county. And I can support totally one of you being on the library board. I'm not going to select somebody, but any one of you would be better than nobody. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. King.
Mr. Yakubowski.
I wasn't finished.
Oh, I'm
I totally support having a supervisor on the board. I was just not prepared for this action tonight, and I wanted to gain more information from Mr. King. The library does great. I have utilized their services tremendously over the years since I've been here, and I can't give them anything but praise. If we're going to vote on a supervisor to be there, I just have one question. Are you able to fulfill all of those obligations?
Yes, Mr. Stabile, just like all of our other board obligations, I'm very easily, four meetings a year, pretty easy to cover. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Yakubowski.
Thank you. And my only concern was I didn't realize we'd be talking about this evening, that's all. And having a board member on there would make sense. So I will share, and as I did at the last meeting, I'll share with our to be representative to the board of new location that we need in the county. Myself and Mr. Skinner have talked about the Massaponics area with all the growth going on, that we need to start targeting that now and start looking now so that we don't get overwhelmed. And with Salem Church being truly the largest library in the system, and our population shifting in location, we truly do need another location down there. So I would ask that you, if you could bring that to them, and we can study that further and see how we can go about doing that. But I fully support it, and I think that that Mr. Ross would be a good asset to have. And I would just ask if you can give us a heads up so that we're not kind of blindsided like we were before of having them come and say we're going to cut hours. So absolutely. Thank you so much.
Mr. Skinner, did you have any more of a report?
No, I do not. I just follow up with the motion to make it clear, nominate Mr. Ross for the CRRL committee.
We want to go ahead and vote on that tonight?
Yes, please.
Six yes. Mr. Benton.
I'll just, not to beat this to death, but I'll just comment on the library real quick. I do totally support our library system and what it does for our community and the citizens. But my issue is just like any other budget, you know, they had their opportunity to tell us the situation we were in at the budget time. 6 months later or so is not the time to come and say, we're going to cut your services if you don't give us this money. It's almost like they're holding us hostage. And I don't mean any disrespect to any of their board members or the library itself, but you know, my thoughts are to hold off till our next budget, and if we are able, put some extra money in it at that time and fully fund it. But you know, I just don't like in the middle of a budget coming up and having somebody basically hold us hold a rock over her head and request money or, you know, cut services. I just don't think that's the, you know, I just would have appreciated somebody coming forward a lot earlier than this, or at least right after their budget sessions and, you know, advising us of this and the situation. Also, during the next budget, I would like to see a little bit more of where the money's going for the libraries when they do our do the presentation, or if they do a presentation. That's all I have.
Mr. Ross, do you have a board report?
I have nothing.
Mr. Cibula?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm pleased to report that last Wednesday and Thursday, I was able to go down to Richmond and speak before the DGIF subcommittee on Wednesday and the full DGIF committee on Thursday on the issue of wakeboarding and 200 and 100 foot setbacks on Lake Anna. And on Thursday, I was it was suggested to me by the chairman, Mr. Bill Bowling, that we also pursue this legislatively in parallel to the administrative process that they're going through. And I would like to add that we were very well received. Now, having said that, I have before me a motion, and I move that the board direct county administration to add to the board's draft legislative agenda the desired regulation of certain water sports and watercraft, which the board, by resolution number 2016-136, adopted on September 13, 2016, requested of the Department of Game and Inland Fisheries to request that the Virginia General Assembly consider and adopt those proposed regulations related to Lake Anna set out in the resolution as law during the Virginia General Assembly 2017 session. So moved.
There's a motion on the floor. Is there any discussion? If not, we'll call the question.
Well, Mr. Chair, could you read that again? I just want to make sure I understood it. Mr. Cibula, I was listening, but since we haven't seen it yet, I want to make sure I know what I'm voting on.
Right. Just in general, the resolution that we approved at the previous board meeting is to be added to the legislative agenda for them to take action on in the 2017 session.
And that would be the 200-foot, 100-foot?
Mr. Ross, and what this is basically county admin, the board has not put together and approved its full legislative agenda. This is just directing staff to add it to that for the board's full consideration at a future date.
And let me just ask one more question. So I know, Mr. Benton, you represent that area too. You support this?
Yes, I do. Okay. Absolutely.
Mr. Jakubowski.
Thank you. Is a motion necessary? Because all we're doing is putting into the package, and we're going to vote on the package later anyway.
Well, the motion is necessary to give direction as a full board to county staff so they know what to add and what not to add. It's basically, you know, the board giving its full direction. So. Just the motion makes it clear, and then the vote, you know, makes it, you know, direction of the full board.
Right. But my only question is that we're still going to vote on the entire legislative package anyway.
Correct.
So adding things to it at this point, having a vote of the board, I just don't know if it's necessary. Not that I don't support it. I'm just not sure why we're doing it that way. That's all.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, I kind of like to chime in on that, too. I got a lot of feedback after that meeting. I know during the meeting, one of the key concepts, I know Mr. McLaughlin voted against it. I came very close to voting against it only because there was so much information that we didn't have at that meeting. So I personally would like to hold off on doing that until we got more information. And then when's it normally added to the legislative agenda? Or when do we go forward with that? The General Assembly meets February of next year?
January.
Okay.
It would be best if you could come up with a legislative agenda in November.
So will that be on our agenda in November?
Yes.
Okay. So we only meet once in November, on November 10th? Twice?
No.
Twice? Okay.
Twice.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Skinner.
I don't need to vote tonight, but I would say that we, without objection, we can put it on there because we can strike it any time, you know, when we're looking at it to vote on it. We can just strike it if everybody doesn't feel like doing it. But I would say without objection, at least add it to it right now, and then we can follow up with more information that was asked for, I'm sure, and then do it that way. But we can direct tonight for staff to put it on, and I think we should.
I have no objection to any of this. I'm just following the recommended administrative process that was provided to me by our legal staff.
Okay.
I'm fine with just...
I think direction.
I would consent to instruct staff to add it.
Yeah. I can pull the motion.
Chair Kowalski.
Thank you. And staying on that topic, first of all, I'd like to thank everybody who was involved in putting together the regional elected officials dinner that we had last week and everybody who was able to attend. It was a very good time. Thank you to Stevenson's Ridge for hosting us, to staff that put the time in to put it together. It was nice to see our colleagues in a friendly setting, and it was nice to talk issues and see that we really have a lot more in common and a lot of issues that we need to work together on, because the common roadblock for local government is state government and then federal government. And so I think that us banding together on the issues that we have in common to move them forward is a positive thing. And one of the ideas that came out of the discussion was, instead of setting up new committees or setting up new organizations, we already have GWRC, and for us to use GWRC to craft a legislative agenda for the region, since every member of the planning district sits on GWRC anyway, they would have a representative that would be able to work this through. So I would ask that our legislative agenda from last year be given to our GWRC members to mold that into a regional one with their legislative agendas, so that they can then come back to us at a later date. I know we're probably a month or two behind on doing this, but I think if we can do that, the better. I know that you had said in November we're going to be discussing our legislative agenda. Would that be the first meeting or the second meeting, Mr. County Administrator?
I'm going to try to get it on the first meeting.
Okay. So after that, perhaps we can then take that, send it to GWRC, and see what can be put together. And then I do believe, Mr. Trampy, you're on GWRC. You would have a meeting then before the second board meeting that we would have. Okay. So then we would be able to bring it back and see if there was a desire to do this or not, if there is enough time or not. But the whole idea was not to get too much into the weeds with generalities, but specific items that we're finding difficulty in when it comes to state government and ordinances or regulations or whatever it might be that is common in the planning district. It might be more common to us than, you know, let's say Caroline, but, you know, they might have an issue that would be more that would affect them more than it would us. So there's some commonality that will be there. There might be a little bit less than on some of the issues, but I think that if we can get together a small number of doable issues and present them and then find out in the springtime, you know, what the what happened. You know, did they pass? Did they not? Was there any reason that they did or didn't? And work together to try to get some of these moving, because I know that I complain a lot about state government and the role that they play in regard to the Dillon rule and everything else that is a hindrance to us in many respects. And so instead of sitting and just complaining about it for 4 years, I would think that it would be better to move something ahead and try to work together. And if we come together as a region, as the High Growth Coalition did up in Northern Virginia, and as we have other organizations that come together working towards common goals, I think that that would definitely be helpful. So I would ask that after our meeting, then, if we could pass that along to GWRC, and also if we can contact our neighbors and just let them know that we're going to kind of do this so that they're not flat-footed either. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you. And for my board report, I'm just going to mention on the library issue, a couple members have mentioned that we felt blindsided by this issue, and I concur. I would note that tonight was the first night, the first time that any vote was scheduled on this issue, yet the newspaper editorialized some weeks ago about a decision that we allegedly had already made. If we approve this funding on November 10th, as I suspect we will, I expect a retraction from the newspaper in the same space and an apology for their error.
Mr. Chair.
That's my board report. Yes, Mr. Skinner.
Mr. Chair, if I could add one more thing to it. You know, there's been a lot of things said up here about being blindsided and stuff of this nature. Obviously, we didn't really know about it. But I want to make sure everybody understands the contract, okay? There is no necessity for us in the contract to put out any particular type of money. And in the contract, what we had, I understood that if we didn't do that, then they could reduce their services. So, you know, when they got up here, I do agree that we got blindsided. There's no doubt about that, that we didn't really get the letter. And I've talked to the director, and I've opened my, I said, please give me a call, give me an email. I mean, I like to talk, know what's going to happen before we get to the meeting. That's the only thing that we could have done in the communications. But I don't want people to think they intentionally sideblinded us, because I don't think they did that. They came in here to say, look, if you can't keep what you said you're going to do, then we have the right to cut services. And so I really don't want the public to think that either side is being a bad guy here. We can either use what we have, the capability of not providing the money. They have then the right to cut services. So it's a determination of this board how important it really is to our children and to everybody out there, how important that library is. So the only thing I can see that maybe could have been is communications, and it always comes down to communications. Maybe if we would have known this a little bit sooner, we wouldn't have done this, you know, we wouldn't have felt blindsided it this way. So we all, and I know a few of us, opened up this yellow package that we get at board meetings and found the letter in it. So either sooner than that or something like this, and that's one of the reasons I think it's very important to have a supervisor on that committee, so we sort of know and we don't get caught in this position, because I don't want the library and I don't want this board of supervisors to be thought of as being the bad guy here. It's not. There's a contract out there. We have the right to decide whether we want to fund it or not. They have the right to decide, if we don't fund it, to cut services. And that's what the contract's all about. So I just want to make that perfectly clear to everybody. Communications would have probably been a big thing, and we wouldn't be here today talking about it if we had better communications. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Taylor, what's next?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Next up, we have a presentation on reassessments of various proffered real estate, our Commissioner of Revenue, and Eddie Talley, our appraiser, here.
Okay, it's working. Appreciate being here tonight. I know there's been some discussion about proffers and how we value the property after they offer the proffers. So there are a couple things I want to go over with you all to let you understand the guidelines that I have to use by state code, and the proffers sometimes are a little bit different in their valuing. The Commissioner of Revenue's office is required to assess all recorded parcels as they exist as of January 1st of each year. For example, the 2016 staff use sales, which occurred in 2014 and 2015. We assess the properties taking into account the zoning along as-is conditions of the parcels. The property is revisited annually as projects evolve. For example, if there is a zoning change in the property in June of 2016, the value would not change until January 1st, 2017. Parcel by parcel basis until the plats subdividing the lots have been recorded. So that means when they have a huge parcel, we value that parcel as a whole. And then when they start recording and separating and making smaller parcels for townhouses or residential homes, that's when we take into account that information. Appraisals used for proffers usually have hypothetical conditions. And we do not get into the hypothetical conditions. We use as is, what has occurred in those past 2 years. As confirmed by the county attorney, that appraisals conducted and furnished for purposes other than tax assessments cannot serve as a basis for the assessment. We have met several times and had this discussion trying to determine, could I use that value, that proffer that they said? And the answer is no. In some instances, these parcels remain in land use programs, which determine the rate and the taxes applied. So that means as long as they continue to use that property in the same use, they can stay in land use. Once they change the use of that property, we do go in and do what we call a rollback tax, and we do current and 5 years in which they pay us taxes back as well as the interest on what they saved on for the past 5 years. So to answer the question about using the appraisal value used by companies for proffers cannot be used for tax assessments. Recently, two of the appraisers from the assessment office met with Planning Community Development and reviewing the existing internal development processes. So they are coming up with the help of us, and we're working as a team to see what we can do to make sure the value of the property as is. And I will say it worked really well. We have worked well with them. Appreciate their help with us. And I'm willing to answer any, Eddie and I are willing to answer any questions you might have.
Any questions or comments from the board? So if the use is the same, the rezoning itself doesn't change the valuation?
Sometimes it can either, when you change the development, like when you go from like a commercial and then y'all have gone back and did a multi-use zoning, that can affect the value of it. It could either go up or it could go down.
Mm-hmm. It was Mr. McLaughlin who requested this briefing. Unfortunately, he wasn't able to be here. So if you have any written material that you could forward on to him, that would be appreciated.
I would be glad to.
Thank you. Mr. Skin.
Just this last question, what you just said. So if we go from residential to commercial, do you look at that property at the beginning of the next year in January, and do you go back 2 years to look at what the value would be commercial? Speaker, I'm sorry. Thank you.
Sorry.
Now you got to get it close, too. Thank you.
The assessment to assessment, the value is established.
Can you get close? I'm sorry. These mics are not the best in the world.
The values are established from assessment to assessment. So if a rezoning takes place in the middle or, say, for October 25th of this year, it would take effect the following January. But the basis for that valuation goes back to the last reassessment.
Right. Thank you.
There's nothing else. Mr. Jaskowski.
I think that where this had come from was that when properties are rezoned, especially some of these larger ones that we have done, there has been the thinking or the belief that that will generate more revenue to then offset the eventual cost of that development. So, for example, if you have an agricultural parcel that then is upzoned to or rezoned to 1,000 homes, the assessment on that parcel from agricultural to potential or eventual residential, I have always wondered what the amount of revenue that is generated from something like that over time would be to offset the, you know, eventual cost that a residential subdivision, if below the break-even point, if they're below the break-even point, how that would offset that cost. And so that's something I don't see. I see that this is largely focused on the proffered use of land to the county, which in some cases, you know, we have had land that's been proffered to us with restrictions, and yet you have the developer who takes the highest and best use of that land as the proffered amount, and now that proffers are done away with, this really doesn't mean anything. But so that they, and granted, it is a parcel in their development that if they were to develop it as they would see fit, it would be X number of dollars. But by giving it to the county and then tying our hands and saying we can't use it for what they might have used it for. So, for example, if we got 5 acres, well, we did get 5 acres or so down in some of these new rezonings, we can't sell it off for a Chili's or for a restaurant or for a commercial use at all. Our hands are tied. And so the value of that, they want full credit, which is understandable. But why the county would, and again, this is all moot because it's done away with, why the county then would accept something like that with our hands tied, that overall development, though, if it went from, and the couple I speak of are down in Massaponix, if they went from a lot of industrial, agricultural, maybe a little smattering of residential and commercial, if they went to a multi-use, what... I think I'd like to see what that delta is between what it was assessed at, and I think we've gone through a year now that we could see, and what the new assessment is to see how much more money that is generating, even if it sits idle, so that that new money you can look of as I hate to use the term, but profit for the county, because then it depends on when the developer moves on their property to do anything with it.
Correct.
So if they sit there for 20 years and they do nothing, and let's just say it's an extra $100,000 over what it was, you know, fine. I mean, that's the county's going to gather that money. But if they then put up, you know, something that costs the county money, for example, residential, you know, then we don't see that benefit. We actually will see a reduction in that. So, I mean, I don't see that in here, and that's some of the questions that I think we had asked before too.
Part of it sometimes in the larger parcels, they get it rezoned, but they don't do anything with that property, and they continue to keep it in land use. So that value is they get the tax rate with the land use value. So until they actually start subdividing the property, adding roads, sidewalk, getting the water and sewer in there, the value is really not there until they actually move on the property.
And can you go back? Is it, you said 5 years. Is that only 5 years you can go back?
Yes, sir. Current in 5 years. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So yeah. if they move on.
That's a state code.
So if they move on in 10 years, you can only go back to the, okay. Gotcha. All right. Thank you.
Mr. Spiela.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So if I have a piece of property that's zoned agricultural, and I want to rezone it for a commercial use and apply for the rezoning and am granted the rezoning, the value is still, the value of the property is still the same as what it was when it was agricultural until some development takes place.
And no, that it'll change the following January, if given the property and the location and the physical characteristics.
It will change with the zoning change the following January.
And the characteristics of the property, yes.
Considering not just the zoning, but the other physical attributes of the property as well, the following January.
Okay, thank you.
If there's no more comments or questions, thank you.
Thank you, and I will send this to Mr. McLaughlin as well. And then if he has any other questions, we'll get back with him. I would like to add one other thing. Nothing, this is personal for me and my office, commissioner, and the assessment office, as well as the county. We are losing a fantastic lady over here, and she will be deeply missed in the way she communicates with the public. So.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kathy.
Next, Mr. Chairman, we have a presentation from finance and purchasing staff regarding changes to county procurement policy. We've been working on an update to improve our process.
Good evening. I am here tonight with Brad Kwan, our procurement manager, to review several revisions to the procurement policy. If you took a chance to, had a chance to look at the track changes copy, there are lots of red lines and a lot of moving around. I think Brad's done a good job of trying to narrow down a handful or so of slides to help walk us through that. There are multiple changes. Many of them are just reorganization and clarification. So I think I'm hoping that after tonight's presentation, and we are certainly happy to answer any questions you have, that we can get your approval on these proposed revisions. Floor computer, please.
All right. Thank you, Mary. And thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the board, to have this opportunity to come to you this evening to highlight the revised updates to the procurement policy. Over the next few slides, I wanted to first just start off very quickly with the purpose of the policy, why we have a procurement policy for the county. And it's to ensure that the county obtains high-quality goods and services at reasonable cost in accordance with the Virginia Public Procurement Act. That's what governs all of our procurements for the county. And to make sure that procurement procedures are conducted in a fair and impartial manner. Why are revisions needed this year? Each year, I do review the policy on a yearly basis for approved legislative updates. This year, revisions are both legislative-driven and recommendations from staff to improve and enhance the current policy. I know this looks like a lot on each slide, but I wanted to make sure that the board was clear on the changes that we are recommending to this policy. As Mary said, there was some reordering and renaming of some of the articles in the policy. General provisions now includes definitions that was previously in its own Article 2. We like those at the beginning of the policy so it's clear the terminology that's used throughout. Procurement and contract management is now separated into two sections to clearly distinguish the differences between the information that's in those two sections. The last article of the policy is the disposition of surplus property and unclaimed property. And we're just adding in the sheriff's possession to the end of that title, and I'll cover that at the last slide. Number nine is just moving language from one section of the policy to the purpose so that it's in the beginning. That's not changing any existing language. It's simply a move from one section to another. Throughout the policy, we're changing public body to the word county so that it's very clear when you're reading this policy that we are speaking directly to the county. We're adding required Virginia code sections as stated there. This is legislative driven, and it makes it clear that we must follow these sections in our county procurement policy. We're adding definitions as listed. These are not new terms, they're just simply defining the terms in the policy. We are keeping dollar limits for architectural and engineering contracts the same, and we're adding a footnote to the policy that will help us keep track of what our current limits are and why we didn't decide to increase the limits to what the state allows. So again, no increase in the limits for this year. The next slide removes the required update to the board for spending on all task order agreements. The key word there, all, because current policy currently states that task orders over $100,000 require board approval, that you're familiar with when we submit task orders for your approval. We just wanted to remove that conflicting language that's in the same section of the policy. Next, we're renaming cooperative procurement to joint and cooperative procurement. This is legislative driven, and we're updating the language in that section to reflect what's in the Virginia Code. We're adding language in the contract requirements section. We're just adding to standard contract forms shall be used whenever practicable. That will be a great enhancement between the county attorney's office and procurement, that we're adding that in the policy this year, and making it clear that over contracts over $100,000 are what's the current process between procurement and the county attorney's office, and contracts over $100,000 coming to the board. So that's just making the policy much clearer. We're removing old language from the posting section. As technologies have changed the last several years, we have made the county procurement website very transparent, so all information is available on our website, and that just simply updates that old language. Next, we're adding a footnote to the preference for recycled paper and paper products. This is a legislative code that we're required to follow. It's actually for state agencies, but we purchase our recycled paper and goods from state contracts, so we easily meet that. We just wanted a footnote in the policy to help understand why that's in our policy and for any future changes. Next, in the competition section, we're just making this a lot clearer in the policy for departments and users of the policy of when quotes are required, what the department's requirements are for storing the records and destruction of those records, and making reference to required forms. They're not new forms. These are forms that have been in place for the last several years. We just want to make sure the policy is clear. Next, we're removing duplicate references that's in the policy in two different sections, the modification to a contract and exception to competition, and changing the word for existing contracts of how those can be extended under current terms. We're also making reference to sole source and emergency procurement forms and adding additional wording to registration and training. Again, these are enhancements to the policy. We're adding clarification to the documents required section. Departments have delegated authority to under 15,000, so we just want to make sure it's clear that those departments are maintaining those records. Nothing new to them. Again, we just want to make sure that's clear. Next, we're just adding the words, but not limited to. This will allow us to add additional criteria for pre-qualifying vendors if that's needed. One huge enhancement to the policy is adding additional language to the selection committee section. This is going to detail the formation of the committee. It states that members must be county employees, and it also states their responsibilities. This is processes that have been in place, but it adds clear language in there as far as what everyone's responsibilities are. The last on this slide is just making reference to a new legislative section that goes into place July of next year of how any public body must purchase U.S. flags and flags of the state. And our last slide here, keeping on the modification of a fixed price contract. We are keeping the limits at the existing 10%. This just adds a footnote that past legislation did increase those limits to 25. The county did not adopt those increased limits. We just want to be able to keep track of that for the future. Next, we're adding a new section, contract administration responsibilities. This is for staff that's designated as a project manager or contract administrator and references the required form. These are not new processes. They've been in place for several years. It just puts this information in the policy to make it clear. In the debarment and suspension section of the policy, this just makes it clear what project manager's responsibilities are to document contractor performance and to make that information known to the procurement division. This is not new. This is processes that's been in place for several years as well. We just want to make it very clear in the policy. Next, a nice enhancement to the policy this year will be electronic signatures. With ever-changing technologies, we want to remove how we defined electronic signatures last year in the policy. This will allow us, for example, to accept signatures from vendors who use secure software. The current definition does not allow for that. And we want to remove procedural steps for accepting the electronic signatures by procurement staff. These changes are allowable under Virginia Code and have been approved by the county attorney's office. And the last is disposition of surplus property and unclaimed property. Adding in the sheriff's possession to the end of that title, it does not change anything for the sheriff's office. They currently do hold unclaimed property in their possession. We just wanted to make sure that that section to the policy is clear. And we're adding some words for clarity in the policy for the users that are using the policy. That's the end of the presentation. I'm happy, Mary and I, to answer any questions that you have this evening.
Are there any questions from the board? Mr. Ross?
Number 20 for the documentation of performance for a contractor. I know that was discussed earlier. As far as getting feedback to the contractor himself also and letting him know ahead of time, so that's going to be included in that?
Yes, that is part of the process too. We want to make sure from the contract administrator and the project manager, good and bad performance, and then that awarded contractor would have an opportunity to come in and meet with us, yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Would it be possible if you would pull up the updated track changes document on the floor computer?
I don't have it loaded to this
okay.
computer. I'm sorry, Mr.
That's
Ross.
All right. So section 2.3D says all contracts over $100,000 and bid documents pertaining thereto. So it looked like before it said all contracts and bid documents shall be reviewed for approval as to form by the county, by the Office of the County Attorney. Have we changed that to now have a threshold of only those over $100,000?
Yes. In reviewing the policy this year, that's one thing that myself and procurement staff realize is that the current process is only contracts over $100,000 require county attorney approval. But without that, it could be interpreted that any dollar amount contract.
So how many, like I'm just interested, so is it worthwhile to have Carl's office review, say, those that are over $50,000? Or how many do you guys review right now, Carl, are you aware of that would, what's the delta, or do we even have an idea?
I don't have that information.
And what kind of things do you find when you're reviewing these? Do you ever find critical errors of those, say, over $100,000?
I would say rare. It's rare that we find a critical error, certainly. You know, but it's a variety of comments, you know, questions. We identify things to note. Sometimes it is a required change to make it approved as the form.
I think that number is a little too high. I'd like to see it lower, but I don't know without knowing how much time it is on your office, Carl, or what kind of things you find or those things. It's,
we can take a look at that. You can certainly move it forward without that change, and that's something we can take a look at if the board desires.
All right. Well,
I'd be happy to do that.
Okay. As we go through here, I'd like to then strike the changes made to 2-3, paragraph D. So I think the major one was on 2-18.
Can I get one point of clarification, Mr.
Yep.
Ross? Are you asking us to strike the change or to change the over 50 to over 100 to over 50?
Just strike the change.
Strike it? Okay. I'm sorry, 2-18 you said?
No, that was 2-3, paragraph D.
Right, the next one, though.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
That's where I'm heading to right now. So 2-18, as I read this, this is where you're talked about source selection committees?
Source selection committees for requests for proposals, yes.
So is this, in essence, you're making the biggest change here is that you're making that anybody that's on a source selection committee must be a member of a paid employee of Spotsylvania County?
Yes, that's right. We do have another sentence that follows that. Should we have a highly complex procurement that we may need outside expertise, that we would have that option to do that. But they would not be a scoring member. They would be an advising member.
Are members of the EDA considered county employees because they get a stipend?
I believe they are. I believe that the way the Procurement Act is written, anyone who is paid, including board members, are considered employees. So if they receive any type of stipend, I believe they're considered public employees.
So planning commission would be the same Anybody that's getting anything from the county?
I believe that's the case.
Yes,
I'm looking to Carl to see if he may know for sure.
Yeah, there's a couple different standards. There's an IRS standard, and Mary may be referring to something else. We can certainly check on that.
So one of the concerns, I know I've seen the conflict of interest forms that we have for those that go to Source Selection Committee. Is the intent of this, by making the person a county employee, to make that conflict of interest form actually enforceable?
Yes, that has been our conversations that we've had in bringing these changes to you, is that when you are a county employee, those Article 6 for ethics would be more, you'll be able to hold that county employee to a higher level of responsibility.
And what would you do if they violated it then? Is it like you would fire the county employee?
If I'm made aware of that, the first thing I would do is consult with the county attorney. But in that form, and I'm trying to get my hands on it really quickly, you could be led.
The criminal charges?
Yes. There is a penalty for violation that's stated in our policy for willful violation of any provisions of the ethics. It could lead to termination, yes.
And what would be, say, if you find a minor violation of our conflict of interest form on procurement in a source election committee, what would be the first thing? Say it's a minor thing. What would be the, how would we enforce that? Obviously, they broke the conflict of interest form, but.
Yes. As I said, I haven't had that personally happen here or in past positions in state procurement. But the first thing I would do is Mary and I would consult with the county administrator and county attorney's office. It may depend on what the nature of that violation is, how big or how small that violation is. So it'd be kind of hard to say exactly what that answer would be at this moment in time without an actual incident happening.
But it's certainly possible that that process would be stopped immediately, because it would be our goal to ensure that procurement is done legally, and if that meant stopping the whole process and starting over, we would certainly do that.
And I'll pick on the Planning Commission. So that's the Planning Commission, the EDA, these are things that are board appointed. Let's say this is hypothetically, if it's a Planning Commission, how would we handle that? Because now you've got, there's part of me that would like to see that no EDA member, none of our stipend, no board member. Has a board member ever been on a source election committee?
In my 2 years as a county employee, no, but prior years, I'm not sure, but I'm pretty certain that the answer to that would be no.
Okay. The section that Brad's referring to is Article 6 of the Virginia Procurement, Public Procurement Act, and it sets of definitions that it refers to a public employee. It says it means any person employed by a public body, including elected officials or appointed members of governing bodies. So all of those people would be included.
Could be included,
yes. Now, it could be your choice, I think, to say paid county employee staff only, if that's what you wanted to do. I'm not suggesting
that
you
couldn't
do that.
But I don't know if the rest of my board members would like that, but I don't see any harm. It would relieve the perception that any kind of good old boy stuff is happening here, I think. I'm going to recommend that we add that to source selection committees, we cannot have anybody that's appointed.
Well, but stating it positively at the beginning of that second paragraph, members of the selection committee must be regular full-time employees of.
Right. That's great.
And that's where we have people that we are positioned for, I'll say, maximal accountability.
Gotcha. Thanks for making it positive. I have another question. And what I didn't see was when we formed these source selection committees for procurement, I didn't see any policy on how you're going to form that. Is there anything in here that addresses that? For instance, let's just say, hypothetically, I'm going to pick on Chief Williford because he's out there and he knows I'm going to miss him in the future. Say that he's got a procurement thing that's going on in the county, a major purchase, and I go to him and I say, you know what, I'd really like Fred and Jim and John on that source selection committee in the county. I go out bowling, they're on my bowling team, and I know John, who's buying this, who's selling something, he's one of the bidders, and I go tell Chief Williford, can I get, so what's to prevent, what can he use? No, I'm not actually doing this. This is a hypothetical, and it's nothing, no truth.
I know you're not, but let me just since you did pick on me, I'll bring to your attention that we have a combination fire and rescue system in Spotsylvania, and we routinely use volunteers within the FREM system on selection committees.
Gotcha. And I wasn't trying to pick. You know what I should call it is, let's just call it a hypothetical, let's get something done committee. So in that case, if I'm trying to influence that, and again, I'm picking on myself because I'm being the bad guy here, but I'm not trying to, I will never try to influence the source selection committee. But if I go out to Chief Williford's counterpart in the Let's Get Something Done committee, and then he comes to you and says, hey, Supervisor Ross has asked for Jim, Bob, and John to be on that. What can you throw back as a policy, say, no, get out of here, get out of my office?
That's one of the things that what we do have in the policy now is that, well, first of all, if that came to my attention, it would be a meeting of the minds to come to my office to discuss that, because for one, I can only do something about something I'm aware of. So I would need to know of those situations. And at any time, if I felt like that person's influence was going to in any way jeopardize that procurement, as Mary said, we would always have that option to say we could cancel that if I felt that it was needed. This policy will also allow us to remove a committee member at any time. So we may have a committee in place and then later find out while proposals are being evaluated, for example, of something that you're speaking of. So this policy does state that we could remove a committee, myself or the county administrator.
The policy actually states that Brad has the authority for the final selection and that the county administrator or Brad can change.
One thing that would be good, because there's also nothing that really says that, and we have a lot of committees in Spotsylvania County and a lot of things where staff is working closely with appointees or non-full-time members. I'd actually like to see something where you can't have a social or working relationship with a proposed winner of a bid. Is there anything in there that would cover that? In other words, I know, for instance, Tom Remora works with a lot of committees, and he might, over time, they may go bowling together, right? I mean, I'm not saying that happens. And let me not use Tom's name because I didn't, just anybody that's in the county. So is there anything that would prevent a known relationship? Let's just say, even say we're on the same committee, county staff's on that committee, they meet once or twice a month, they go out afterwards maybe, and they have a familiarity and somebody is potentially going to win a contract or then does win a contract. What can we go back into our policy to prevent that from happening in the first place? Is that in the conflict of interest form?
The ethics speaks, it doesn't really speak to those informal relationships. Right. It speaks much more to formal relationships, employees of other companies outside, that type of thing. The actual ethics article, I don't know that there's anything in here that I could say even sounds similar to what you just said, like no friendships, no relationships at all. Now, certainly I can tell you, from our perspective, when someone brings to Brad a list of selection committee members, he's quick to look at that committee, to make suggestions, to make for changes. We actually have a list of people in our office that we think are great people to serve on committees that maybe have nothing to do with that department at all.
Right, that's good.
And that's what we're trying to do, is to make sure that we get the right people. You don't have to necessarily be an expert in that field to review an RFP and see what the proposal suggests, and then to review the proposal and see if it meets the RFP requirements. And so Brad's going out of his way and has consistently tried to do that, to make sure that we get the right group of people to review that RFP. But I don't know that there's anything, Mr. Ross, specifically in this ethics form, and they are required to sign this form to say that they understand the ethics laws and that they understand that breaking those laws is a misdemeanor. Okay. And it could result in loss of their job, which is why another important factor that they need to be employed or losing their job really has no value.
Right. Sure.
But to Monty's point, if he is consistently using volunteers, then that may become an issue if we make this thing, say, regular full-time employees only.
Right.
Yes, it would.
I don't know.
Maybe we should put it with the exception of volunteers.
I just bring that up. Certainly it's up to you all to decide how you want to handle that.
And Mr. Ross, if I could just emphasize, and Mary touched on it, if somebody, I mean, you know, we can put forward administrative penalties in the policy. However, if somebody is steering work to a friend or getting a kickback, or if there's, you know, some untoward relationship in the award of public contracts, I mean, that is potentially a criminal violation that would be turned over to the Commonwealth's Attorney's Office for investigation.
Gotcha. Thank you, Mark. Okay. On page 20, it says section 2-22, paragraph B. It says that cost estimates relating to, and it, I wasn't quite sure what the change was. Cost estimates relating to a proposal procurement transaction prepared by or for a, and it says the county.
It used to say public body, and public now it just says, this is one of those places where we changed it to reference the county instead of public body.
Okay.
Public body is a standard form language that's used in the Procurement Act, and we had not, apparently someone had cut and pasted some of that information from years ago. We just wanted to clean it up to make sure
so they understand. So all, and that goes into my last question. So all the county replacements, it used to say
public body.
Public body.
Yes.
And what does that, in some of these cases, I'm like, well, what does the county decides? What does that mean? So in like in paragraph C, any competitive sealed bidder, and I'll go on, it says, except in the event that the county decides not to accept any of the bids. Is that really the procurement office?
Yes.
Yes, it would be.
All right. Thank you.
Mr. Benton.
Back on the one prior to the last, where for the committees. Mm-hmm. How are the, I'll just bring back an example. Years ago, this, I didn't know I was part of a committee like that, but I was just told to go down and be, since I was, knew a little something about safety and terrorism, stuff like that, that I'd be, I won't mention the department. I'm trying to keep it clean. But anyway, I was placed on this thing along with another public safety person, and we went on this, I'm assuming it's the committee that you're talking about, to view some people that wanted to do some work. And there was like six companies that came in, and we heard all of them. And, you know, two of us, not being associated with the actual work being done, liked another company. And the one that was ended up being selected, you know, the fella gave a horrible presentation, basically came in and said, well, you know me. I've worked for the county before. I do good work. And be quite honest, because I was not an expert on the actual work to be done, we were actually influenced by the department representatives that were on there. So, I mean, I don't know how you, because really the guy gave a horrible, horrible presentation. I can't underline, capitalize, quotes, horrible presentation. But the other individuals were familiar with his work. And I guess what I'm getting at is, how do we maybe stop some of that?
Brad can walk you through the process, the current process. As okay.
Has that changed where you
I'm not sure when that occurred, I'll be honest with you.
It was during the 9/11 stuff, yeah, shortly thereafter.
I can tell you there's a lot of effort that Brad and his staff make now to explain what the process is about, to control the process to the best of their ability, including their attendance at those meetings so they can stop things from happening that shouldn't happen. They can happen. They can say, enough, this shouldn't be talked about. They're very clear about what you can and can't talk about in advance of the grading, because it really is a grading scale. You assign a number, and those numbers are calculated mathematically to determine who is the top bidder. There's a packet here of things that you have to do, and there's a signature that says you're going to do it. And it includes that penalty of violation. Okay. So
well, then I'll stop, because that has apparently changed. Okay. Since all we did was a vote.
Yes.
I believe, and I can speak to the 2 years that I've been here, the changes that I've brought forward that I thought were greatly necessary. And one of the things, as Mary spoke to, is we require the committee members now to come and meet with the procurement officer, whether it's myself or another member of procurement, okay, to walk them through. Because the last thing that I want is someone, as you just gave an example, hey, can you just serve on this committee? Not have a clue what you're doing. You really want to make sure that that person has the expertise in that area. And not only that, but do they understand what the procurement requirements are? And something that could happen that I've changed that maybe wasn't in place then is we actually have a scoring criteria now for the actual interview. We actually score that, because a lot of times their proposal is excellent that you're reviewing in their glossy three-ring binder, but when they actually come and present, you could score them for the interview. It's just like much like a job applicant has an excellent resume and application, but when you interview them, you may find that that's entirely not the match of what you were reviewing on paper.
Okay, well, then I apologize, because apparently y'all on top of it have changed things for the better. I appreciate it.
Yes, thank you.
Mr. Skinner.
Mr. Ross, if you could clarify one thing for me. when you struck it for $100,000, what are we going to get? And this is for a county attorney, I think. You're going to check at $50,000. You said something about going down to $50,000.
Well, right now the language has any contract, it looks like. So he's already got any contract coming through the county, but he, but Carl can't tell how many range between zero and $100,000, correct?
Yeah, I definitely want to look at that. Yeah. So I would ask that you move it through without that change. Let me take a look at that again, and we'll revisit it.
I don't mind moving that on and striking it right now. But what are you going to provide us of how many contracts and the values of those contracts up to $100,000? Or because I, Mr. Ross, was your statement was you'd like to maybe move that down to $50,000.
I said that, but then it was clarified that it was actually a zero as written. So it's probably not overburdening Carl because he would know about it. So,
yeah, I definitely want to look at that. Yeah. Thank you.
Oh, okay. And when will we... When's the plan? Next meeting, 30 days, the second meeting in November? When's that going to come to us?
I'm okay with us passing this forward with the exception of that, and then maybe
right.
We could just have...
Yeah, I don't have a problem with that either. I just want to know when that's going to come back to us, because I don't want to leave it out there,
sure.
To be honest with you. I want to make a decision on it and decide what we really want to do. So is 30 days the second meeting?
A lot of it's going to depend on how we can aggregate those numbers. And Brad, I'm not sure how easy
together,
that is
Carl.
For you.
Yes, Carl and I will work together on that. But I just want to make sure that it's clear, and I think it has, but it may be worth repeating. In the policy now, the reason that was the actual recommendation that I had to insert that over 100,000, because when I reviewed it as written, it's been at least back to 9 or 10 years that only contracts over 100,000 have gone to county attorney. My concern being new coming on board was, why aren't contracts for $1,000 going to county attorney? And everyone that I spoke to said, well, because that's just the current process.
I
wasn't comfortable not having that in the policy to fall back on.
Okay.
So as Carl is very familiar with and his staff, we do only send contracts over 100,000 for at least the last 9 or 10 years.
No wonder you don't know, Carl. So, and the reason you're doing that is because it's just the way we've always done it?
Been the process.
It's gotcha. Been the process, but I'm certainly not one that goes with it just because that's
right.
The way it's been done.
Mm-hmm.
But in looking at the workload from procurement as well as county attorney staff, you also have to look at the risks that are involved in such dollar amount contracts as well, and how we have our current thresholds, given departments levels up to 15,000 and then procurement from 15 to 100. I think we do mitigate a lot of those risks, not needing county attorney review under 100. There are times where we will request review for under 100 if we feel it's a highly complex or maybe a highly political procurement. We would absolutely do that.
All right. Okay, I'd like to know that too, because there are certain things I think that the department heads need to understand, or they shouldn't be department heads. Okay, very seriously.
Right, absolutely.
And it shouldn't be to the point where it has to be reviewed. Now, I understand a certain value could be jeopardize us, but there are certain things that we have to have department heads do, and if they can't do it, then we need a new department head. So that was my concern. Thank you.
Mr. Spiel? Yes, on a somewhat lighter note, item 17, if I'm not mistaken, requires that we purchase American flags, that they be made in America.
Yes, that's correct, and I should have stated that, so thank you for bringing that to their attention, yes.
Yes, and I just wanted to add something for the general public out there. I would ask that you, anytime you purchase a flag in any store, you look at the source and see where it's made. I have gone to make purchases and made in China, and I don't need to buy an American flag made in China. So I bring this to your attention, and as I say, it's on a lighter note, but I think this is a very important purchase. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for bringing that to the attention. I appreciate that.
Ross, is there a motion?
Yeah, I can make a motion to approve with the exception of paragraph 2-3-D and leave that as is until we get more information.
And do you want to clarify the language on the employees?
Clarifying that it'd be full-time employees with the exception of volunteers from the fire department.
Thank you, Mr.
Fire Rescue.
Thank you.
Is there further discussion?
I just have one more.
Mr. Ben.
Just one more quick question. Did y'all vet this with any of the department heads and stuff like that do put together
That we spent some time reviewing it with county admin, both deputy county administrators and obviously the county attorney staff, and we spent many days and hours reviewing with their staff.
Okay.
Some of it, like I said, is just reorganizing it, and what we found is that the policy had been in place for many years, and as things were added, they were just put in here and there. We tried to get it reorganized, and we tried to make some footnotes to make it understand, make everyone clear to everyone what items were available, maybe through legislative, that we weren't taking advantage of now, so that we can remember in the future why this board made the decisions they did.
Right. So. And I think it'd be appropriate to acknowledge that Mr. Kwan did a Herculean task of reorganizing and pulling in the first draft simply notes, historical notes on changes or matters needing to be addressed, and then we worked from there. So it's been a multi-layered, several different drafts, many different meetings, good involvement, and I think we got a good result. Thank you, Brad.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Taylor.
Yeah, obviously, you know your stuff. Actually, just in listening to you and the way you've presented, I'm very impressed with you. It's just it might be helpful at some point, especially when there's specific changes, not so much legislative, but to put it out to the department heads that do a lot of the finagling.
One thing that I will be doing is having training with, which I've done since I've been here, but now what I'll be doing is countywide training, especially for directors and project managers that are administering contracts. But with these changes, I will say that make it clear that there's not going to be added work on departments or department directors. It's processes that have been in place that they're aware of. But in my past experience with the school system, I'm happy to say that we'll have that training. And one of the things that we'll do is make sure that people sign that they attended that training so that they later can't say they weren't aware of something.
Well, again, I appreciate what you do for the county, and we obviously have a great asset with you, and I'm impressed. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that comment.
There are no more questions or comments. We'll call the question.
Six yes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for your time tonight.
Thank you very much, Ms. Kwan. Next up, we have a status presentation on the animal shelter project.
Good evening. Floor computer, please. Tonight, we'll give a short presentation concerning the Spotsylvania County Animal Shelter renovation and expansion. Similar presentation was scheduled for October 11th, was deferred to coincide with the final design task order, which will be under consideration tonight. During this period, staff has engaged with project stakeholders to develop a program to meet their needs while maximizing the space usage and remaining within the current project budget. Today's presentation will be an overview of the results of that stakeholder engagement, followed by a recommendation by staff to approve the task order to Mosley Architecture for final programming and design of the project in the amount of $377,284. The generalized project scope is there's a current available budget of about $3.7 million available to construct and renovate the facility. The renovation portion of the project will consist of renovating approximately 8,765 square feet of the existing facility, updating the animal holding areas to be compliant with state veterinary laws, new kennel systems, addition of dedicated intake areas per code, once again per state veterinary law, and rework of administration and clinic spaces. The expansion, which is nearly double the size of the existing facility at 7,900 square feet, will include support adoption activities and expand animal housing, along with allowing for additional administrative support space. This gives you a very rudimentary idea of what the facility will look like. On the right-hand side on that top graphic, you'll see is the existing facility with the expansion being in the left-hand. So if you go to the animal shelter now and you look face first at it, it'll be on the left-hand side. The expansion will be on the left-hand side to where the parking lot is now, where utilities vehicles are currently parked. The lower portion is a back view of that project. the existing, when you see the large garage door, that's the Sally Port where the animal control officers bring in the current strays and animals. And then the right-hand side will be connected with a breezeway or enclosed hallway into the expansion adjacent to the building. This gives you a rough idea of what the actual internal facility will look like. On the right-hand side of the line is the existing facility. It will receive light to moderate renovations throughout, including the animal holding areas, administrative space, provide a little bit more additional space for the clinic facilities, additional storage. And then the left-hand side of that line, when you look at it, is the expansion, which is primarily aimed at supporting the adoption activities that take place at the shelter. With that, staff recommends tonight the approval of the task order Mosley Architecture for the final design and programming for this project in the amount of $377,284. And we stand now ready to accept any questions you may have.
Any questions or comments from the board? Mr. Skinner.
You know, Ed, this is probably for you. When did we as a board decide to go with the expansion instead of building a new one? I mean, did I miss something? I have to be very honest with you. My memory's not that great, but I'm figuring how far back ago did we decide that we were going to do an expansion? Because we had land available. We had some money available, too. I know that the new building was outrageous as far as the cost-wise, but when did we as a board decide to go with an expansion rather than a new building?
We looked at several alternatives, and the alternative for construction of a new building, those cost estimates came back originally in the neighborhood of over $12 million. Mm-hmm. Then we relooked at the numbers, and we were able to get it down to about $10 million. The budget that we had to work with is $3.7 million. We looked at several alternatives to get the project within the budget, and the addition of the 7,900 square feet was what we could afford within the budget to expand the existing facility.
Well, I understand what you had to work with. And it's just, you know, there were a couple issues that we had with this. One was location. Very few people know where the location of the animal shelter is. So we were trying to figure out if we could put it to where it was more recognizable if you're just driving down the street, something of that nature. And you say you were given a budget of $3.7 million, but this board has the opportunity to, you know, to take bond money. And the question of that nature is why, I mean, to me, I'm not sure that this board has had a lot to say about it, other than the 3.7, and then you guys all took it on, I guess, and it's a good motivation. I mean, it's good initiative. Figure what you could do with the money and what we could get from it, and I'm sure it's going to be a nice place. The next question is that going not just meet the requirements by the state? Is it going to give us what we need for the next 10, 15 years, or 20 years?
We estimate that this will get us the next 20 years.
Okay. Well, that's good to know. I just, you know, sometimes since this was an issue that I think a lot of board members had a lot of interest in. And I'm not sure we took it as far as we could have as far as what we actual budget was that we could have come up with as a county to build this. And I'll be honest with you. You know, there's a lot of buildings out there still in a time to where nobody's doing a lot. You know, the building isn't just so that people turn you down. It's still the same way with we did the other buildings over there with the public safety building or the judicial building. And that is we got it at a time where people needed to work and we got it at a lower price. Now, did we actually go out for any bids to other companies to see exactly what we could get for what we needed?
We did some investigation into the cost of the existing Company 11, Company 5 fire stations, and that price per square foot is approximately $240 a square foot, and that is right in line with where our animal shelter expansion is at. So we feel those prices are reasonable based on the cost estimations for a commercial building.
Well, I will take a look at the Fire 11 since it's one that I was involved in. It's also Mr. Cibula's territory over there, district. But is that the type of building we really needed for animal shelter? I mean, could it have been a steel building insulated on the inside? Because there are some buildings out there that are cheaper and probably may have given us more room of that nature. I mean, and my point is, we really didn't get much of an update here. We didn't play much of this part. I think we kept asking, how's the animal shelter coming? How's the animal shelter coming? And then all of a sudden, we've now got what we're doing. And I think we've been, I know that Mr. McLaughlin's had that. I've had that same question, is where are we going with the animal shelter? And I just feel like now we're sort of committed to this and you're asking for final design of this one. And to me, it's just sort of, once again, we're up here and going to make a decision tonight to go forward with this, and I just don't think we've been briefed properly on it. I'm willing to go forward, but I just think there's so many other things. Did we really do due diligence as far as what we could get, where we could get it? Because now we're still at the same place, and people are going to have the same problem as, where's the animal shelter at?
We did do a board communication to the board, laying out three or four options to the board, including new construction. And we came back to the board, and I don't know the date that we did come back to the board after the board communication. I was under the impression that this was the option that the board wanted to move forward with. I wasn't instructed otherwise. We can certainly take another look at those options that we looked at.
No, but I want to echo that, Ed. That was part of the, and I can't call the date, Mr. Skinner, but we can certainly revive the presentation, bring it back. There were multiple options, both build new at another site versus expanding the existing facility. We were under constraint of what was money that was already in the CIP and the parameters of what had been approved in the prior bond referendum, but we need to pull those details back in order to answer this question. But it was a board decision that was made to go with the expand in place option. I just can't tell you what date that vote was taken. Sitting here this evening, I apologize.
Okay, well, my memory must be bad because I my recollection is we kept asking, and then I know that Ed said we could expand it up there. But I don't remember us ever going into detail as far as any quotes out there for prices and stuff, actually see what it was out there and stuff of that nature. My concern is this, is that, you know, I know we're under restraints from the state, the violations that we've had. We want to get them corrected, okay? But we could have, you know, I'm just taken back a little bit, that's all. Because this is not the way I say. We have some land available to us. That was one of the questions that were given to us. And I believe that land that was given to us was on Route 1. That was given by Jackson Village, that we had 27 acres up there. I had spoken to the Sheriff's Department. Sheriff's Department said that'd be great if people saw it from 95. So then they know where the animal shelter is like this. And it's perhaps my fault, but, you know, I know that Mr. McLaughlin and I have always asked about that, and I'm not sure how we got to this point completely, and if you've got that record on there, Mr. Taylor, I'd be happy to take a look at it and see what the, if we can take a look at that, I'll be happy to say I'm sorry, but right now I feel like the, and it looks like a good, it looks like a very nice addition to the animal shelter, Ed. And if we're going to take care of it for 20 years, if it's going to meet our needs for 20 years, I can certainly appreciate that, and I can say, okay, let's go forward with it, all right. But I just don't think the process was quite what I expected. Let's put it that way. So.
Mr. Benton.
I do remember the discussions also, and I remember us voting on it. I can't say when, but I just got a couple questions. You say it's good for 20 years?
Yeah, it all depends on how much your animal intake is, but based on the current numbers, we would expect this thing to easily last, you know, 15 to 20 years, unless you have some change in the number of animals we're actually taking in.
Okay. And are we able to, if needed in the future, are we able to expand further on this building?
No, sir. Without land acquisition adjacent to the existing property, there's really no, this basically maximizes out the use of the existing space.
Is there land acquisition that we could make?
Not at this time.
We may want to look into that.
We keep an open feeler on that, so we look at that option of adjacent properties, and if they come available, we investigate that.
All right. And can you go back to your last slide?
The questions. The floor one. Plan?
Yes.
Okay, here you go.
All right. Are you able to explain some of these? I guess all these up here on the left and right are the kennels.
Yeah, if you look in the dark divider line, the right-hand side is the existing building. The dog kennels that you see there.
Yeah, I'm looking at the one on the right, the new one.
No. Trying to find the winter options. So let's see.
Okay,
are you
can be kennels here and kennels there?
Yeah, there can be.
Okay. All right. Go ahead.
I'll say the existing facility. These are the main dog kennels. Yeah,
okay.
This area is the main dog holding area. It looks like here we're going to have on the side also here you have dog isolation. That's anything with concern with the disease. Dog observation. Mr. Tidings is here. He could answer questions specific to the actual process, I believe, their intake and how they process. With dog observation, would be in this portion with the a few main dog holding areas through here, and then court case dogs on the right-hand side of that, they're mandatory holds. The left-hand side of the structure, that is primarily, for lack of a better terminology, your clean side. Pretty much once the animals have been brought through an intake through the renovated existing facility, they will be processed and then ready for adoption. And the canines will be housed in this area here. One of the key features of the sheriff's office wanted to see how this project was keeping the canines and the felines somewhat separated. Just because the undue stress on the feline population. That's what we've tried to do with this project, with the main cat room in the backside, as opposed to being integrated in with the canine areas, actually stands completely separate. And then an adoption cat tower area in the front area, once again, keeping them as far away as we can from the canine population.
Okay. How about all these other rooms? I mean, there's a ton of rooms here.
Basically, you have, if you walk in the vestibule, that's basically you just have the two-door vestibule there. You come in. On the right-hand side will be a reception area with one or two workstations, a working shelter manager location, which is here. That will be basically running the adoption center and the shelter staff. You'll have these rooms are through here, what they call real-life rooms, which are basically a part of the current industry standard in adoption facilities, where they're actually made to be more of a home environment for the animals. One, it helps in the adoption and the connection between the adoptee and the actual dog or pet to be adopted. And also, it allows the animal to be more conducive to adoption because it's not just in a cage the entire time. It's actually in an environment that's somewhat realistic to a home area. These two offices here, the exact layout is not 100% yet. That's actually part of the task order to finish up the final programming. But those will be office support staff, probably for ACOs or shelter staff. We're looking at having a multi-purpose room in the center here. That actually be an enclosed room with probably some skylights on there to make sure you had enough natural lighting. Once again, this exact layout is up for discussion as part of this task order finalization. Then on the back side, we'd have two more office areas, administrative support areas, adjacent to an animal kitchen, basically because you have to have, by code, a spot to basically prep their food and keep it in a contained and safe environment. And we'd also have an internal conference training space back on the left-hand side, which would have access to a staff toilet and storage adjacent to that. Skip ahead to the front of the room. In front of the building, you'd have a vegetation room. Pretty much that's where people come in, and if once again, additional, basically an isolated spot where you can be introduced to the animals and or visit with an animal that you have there in care. Adjacent to that is the puppies room. There's actually two puppy spaces there. Basically, you want to keep your puppies isolated away from the main dog holding. That's both mainly combination of concern over health concerns, but also just it's easier to get those animals adopted out in that environment as opposed to a main dog holding facility. The other two major changes, it's kind of already been highlighted over, but right in front of here, you'll see two little recessed areas. That's behind that in the exit areas, that's actually mechanical space. But those two little recessed areas are actually small mammals and reptiles. You'd be surprised apparently how many of those that the animal control staff take in each year, so they need a dedicated spot to house those in a safe environment. After talking with the sheriff's office and with clinic staff and shelter staff, they feel that this, and they can welcome to speak for themselves, they would like this meets their current desired needs for the facility. I mean, this is basically the highest and best use of that existing partial and that existing square footage.
Can you walk us through the rest of it? This is the first time me seeing this, and I've just
on the right hand side. We'll go
see
back.
See what we're getting for the money.
Okay. The on the left hand side is. Are you okay with the expansion?
Everything you've highlighted is okay. Good. What are these rooms over here on the?
This right here is the mechanical, electrical. That's of course going to be basically your MEP stuff to support the facility. Probably IS related gear as well. Once again, we talked about the staff toilet being off of the conference room. That may be adjusted slightly when we get to that final task order stage. And then this right here is actually just storage. The facility itself currently does not have a lot of storage. It has a couple of small closets, but certainly nothing that meets their current needs. You'd have two accesses from the expansion into the existing facility. You'd have one here, which would be a corridor connector, and then you'd have one here, which would also be a corridor connector. This front corridor connector would probably most likely be used for the public only, and the rear section would be for primarily staff and shelter staff and animals and processing between the two facilities. So you're not walking the animals or walking the cats through the public spaces or where you might have interactions that you don't want to have happen between the animals in those spaces. That pretty much sums up the expansion. Now, the things that we're going to be doing to the existing facility primarily concentrate short of the refurnishing and the kennel systems and the main dog holding area and the backside will be the addition of a dedicated dog intake or canine intake and a dedicated cat intake area. Those are actually being dictated by state code, so we have to have two separate areas for that. They can't just have them out and about in the sally port. Just mostly because of the fact that you have to be able to decontaminate the facility should an animal be sick or, keep that disease from passing along. There will be minimal improvements to the animal kitchen. That pretty much kind of stays roughly where it's at now in the existing facility. There will be some changes to the euthanasia room and the food storage room, but once again, those will be light, minor renovations. Cat observation will basically remain where it's at now, just because of the inability to find additional space for that. So once the cats are cleared for adoption, they are moved back out and into the expansion for the main cat room or the cat tower room, depending on what staffing wants to do.
All right, so I had a question on the... So ahead. We have another food preparation area, is that with it?
Yeah, basically that's another issue there. You want to make sure that, because of the location... Basically because of... hygiene issues, you want to make sure that your healthy animals and your adoption side stay healthy and that if you had anything on the other side, that it stays contained. Also, the fact is the mechanics of it's longer than you think with the time you make from here all the way up to the front to feed the animals. It also tries to keep the time staff does in transit to feed those animals down in the facility. Once again, this is not really short of light renovation. It's not adding huge cost to the project. Once again, it's an existing facility, existing area.
Okay.
The cat isolation area, which is up here, that will remain. Pretty much no changes to that. Once again, once those cats or felines go through that process and are cleared, they'll move into the adoption areas. The toilet, existing toilet area right here and the locker room area will remain pretty much unchanged, just because of relation of moving the plumbing and things like that. Just there was really no immediate need to remove those facilities. Up in the front of the facility is kind of what you'll see the biggest changes. Right now, if you come through the double doors, it pretty much comes into an open lobby and with a reception space here in this box here, and then a small divider door that goes into the Kinchelow Clinic space. With this project, we're looking at doing some light to moderate renovations throughout that front facility, turning this area more into an enclosed administrative support space, with the ultimate use being shared administrative support space with ACOs or shelter staff at the clinic, or basically however operationally they see fit to use that space. We'll also have one additional large clinic or just overall storage area in the front. Once again, the facility is desperate need for storage. It just does not have sufficient storage to meet its current needs. And then we'll readjust the interior walls, non-load-bearing walls inside of that lobby area to provide more of a lobby area where the clinic can come into, or the clinic customers can come into and be there out of the weather. If you've been there at any point, you see there's a large number of folks waiting outside. So we try to work closely with them as part of this recent stakeholder gathering to kind of try to meet as many of their needs as we could. So the ultimate layout of that will be formulated as part of this task order and basically what I call the final programming stage. So when we hit the final programming stage, the exact layout of inside of that existing space will be confirmed. And once again, we'll work with the stakeholders throughout to make sure that, you know, their needs are being met. So
I appreciate you going over that with me. And then as far as the needs, did we just go with personnel from Spotsylvania, or did we reach outward or through state or anything else as far as the actual needs?
The needs are based on, basically, we had our stakeholder group of the Kinchelow Clinic. We had stakeholder from the actual animal shelter staff itself, and then we had the stakeholder group from the animal control officers. So we had three stakeholder groups. The next step is when we get this final programming done as part of the task order, should the board approve it, will be to reach out to the state vet, which Mr. Tidings has been in constant contact with them, so they kind of know what's going on, and basically say, hey, this is what we're doing. Any concepts or any ideas that you have that we can incorporate, it'd be great. But generally, at this point forward, we'll start moving into more of a final programming and making sure that the layouts meet building code and state veterinary code and so forth.
All right. Thank you.
Okay.
Mr. Jakubowski.
Thank you. And thank you for the tour. Quick question, and this kind of goes to my concern that I've had during this whole process, is that we're given the amount of money, and we go out to our voters and say, please approve this so that we can do this. And then we find out that the only option that will buy is an expansion to what we currently have, hoping that that will be sufficient for the life of the bond, 20 years. And we all hope that it will be, but in the event that it isn't, it seems that we're backing ourselves into a corner with this building. And has there been any thought to, as I saw a lot of the office space was interspersed in that area, has there been any thought given to a potential second story to then move that storage out of the way upstairs and expand for more animal care? Because we're now a no-kill shelter. Plus, we picked up Fredericksburg's animal control. Plus, we're growing, and we're going to continue to grow. And so I'm hoping that you're correct, that we will be fine for the next 20 years. But if we're not, what is the backup plan if that falls through, if we get inundated, if you know, if it turns out that in 10 years or 7 years, we need to start looking at another expansion, what is that next expansion beyond, well, let's buy some more land and put up another expansion? Do we have more than just one alternative?
We looked at a second story, both on the expansion and also utilizing some of the storage area that's within the existing facility that's on a loft area. The problem you ran into was the time that you went through and, especially in the existing facility, started looking at the requirements of basically the elevators, elevators to go up, fire escapes, and the infrastructure required for that, you ended up not getting that much more space. Like I said, basically where that facility is going to be located at now and that expansion, I mean, it, without additional property acquisition, which, you know, it could always happen, you know, you're pretty much limited. That's pretty much the footprint that you're going to see to factor in the parking, to factor in trying to still provide a little bit of a grassy area in the outside for the animals to be, you know, things like that. So we tried to evaluate every option we had to provide the highest and best use for this project for the ACO officers and also the clinic and the shelter staff. And when we boiled everything down, this became the most logical solution to this problem. Like, once again, we looked at doing vertical, but unfortunately, by the time you factor in all those additional requirements, it just didn't gain you that much more space.
So to my question of, then do we have a backup plan beyond land acquisition? The answer would be then no, even if it's not cost effective, you know, because 10, 15 years from now, we don't know what the landscape's going to look like. And it would be nice to have that, you know, as a backup plan that, yes, it will be more costly, but shutting down the entire facility and moving it to another location would be even more costly. So are we building this with an eye to the future? And it sounds like we're building it to then, when it's full, and then we move on. So there's no ability to, the structure is not built to accommodate anything except what is currently being proposed.
That's correct.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Are there any other comments, Mr. Skinner?
If you go back to the slide, the second one, the layout, I've got one question for you. Being over there a couple of times, which looking through this.
That's one you
okay.
Want to see?
Okay. You had, I believe that there was an area there for medical, they kept the medicine and stuff of that nature in the old building, where medication, so shots and stuff like that, animals that needed medication were given. There was an area there that you had preparation for that. In the old area now I'm talking
okay.
about. Okay. And I believe it was, I don't know, somewhere around the, can you show me that?
I'm trying to vision where he has that, where they have medical storage at. Mr. Tidings, if he's here, he may be able to answer that question more directly than I can in terms of exactly the existing operational layout of the facility.
And the other question I have for you too now, I've been in those kennels, and they're very loud when somebody walks in. So you've got the dog on the new section. You've got the dog kennel. How soundproof, or how, you know, is in the area we have now? It's all open. Okay, this area that the dogs are going to go into, the new area, once they've been approved and moved over there, is that a closed room, or is it going to be once again like we see open? Because you got the cats right next to it, and you're talking about making cats nervous, or the stress on the cats because of the noise. To me, unless those are secure enclosed rooms, you're not decreasing the stress that they've got now.
And they are. That one of the reasons when you think about when you walk into that existing facility, and it's something hopefully we'll be able to address with the renovations of the existing facility, is the fact that when you walk into the main dog holding areas, you know, there's nothing above you. It pretty much goes straight up to the ceiling joists and the roof. So actually we're looking at doing more of a drop ceiling in there with sound attenuator to try to keep that sound level control within the existing facility. And then the new canine holding area for the adoptions will be also be an enclosed room with sound attenuation.
Okay, thank you for that. Tidy, good evening, sir.
Good evening. To answer your question where we medicate, currently, where you see in the current facility where it's got now the cat intake and dog intake, right behind the animal kitchen there, that's where all that takes place currently. That's where you're talking about.
Right in that area there?
Yes, sir.
Do we have any of that over on the other side that we're going to, or is that one for everything? I didn't see that when you were discussing it in the new area. Where is the new medical, or is it going to be a new medical place where for medication is stored and stuff of that nature?
Basically, items such as that basically we worked out during the spinal programming stage, because we're really going for this was the overall square footage that we can do and adjust internal walls and use, and room uses, and when we get through the spinal programming prior to final design.
Okay. So, I'm sorry, I didn't quite understand exactly what you said there. We don't have one right now in the new area.
The next stage of the project is to meet with the stakeholders. Once this task order is approved, it includes final programming and final design. Part of that final program will be reviewing all the uses of the internal rooms and really kind of making sure that all the needs are set. So, you know, we may call out an area called a storage, but we end up having to change that use based on the stakeholders' input. So, that's something that is critically important to the shelter and the ACOs. We'll certainly accommodate that within the facility.
Because if you're doubling the usage here, I mean, I've been there and I've seen that room. It's not the biggest room in the world out there. If you're going to have twice as many animals over there, I would think you'd need a little bit bigger room than what you've got there now. Okay, that's my opinion, being over there quite a few times, looking at it and seeing everything. And the last thing I'd say is a comment, is a follow-up on Mr. Jakubowski's question. Is there any way that we can go upwards? And you said with a 7,900 square foot, you're adding that to the current 8,765. That's what the new section is going to be, about 7,900
feet? 7,900 square feet, correct.
And you're saying with that, we could not get anything because of an elevator? An elevator is mandated by the state for two floors? Or?
You'll get space, but by the time you factor in dedicated fire escapes and access and elevators, is it the biggest bang for the buck? We could go back and look at this expansion and look harder at a two-story expansion, but the costs will be significantly more than the current budget allows. So we're open to that. We're open to discussions on potentially taking that or looking at it as a two-story expansion. But once again, fully know well that that would be in excess of the current allotted budget.
Okay. Well, I think Mr. Jakubowski brought up a good question on that, point on that, yep. Chris. Because if we find, and again, you've even said here tonight that we really, yeah, we're okay, but we don't know. We could, and Chris said we got more people. We've had a lot of applications. We've been told how many homes are going in there. We've been, criticized for that. So now we're taking it that we'll have enough room. But what happens in 7 years or 10 years? And it always does happen that way. It seems like we don't think out enough in the future. So,
Mr. Cibula has been waiting patiently.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. This proposed project meets all of the state requirements that we've been written up for. Is that correct? And they have looked at this design and approved this design, that it will meet their requirements?
That's correct.
Okay. And get into Mr. Jakubowski and Mr. Skinner's concerns about expansion. Is there any reason why we could not construct the addition to support a second story in the future and not spend it now because we don't have the money to do it now?
We looked at that option of actually increasing your foundations and your interior your load-bearing walls to support that. The problem you get into is at that point, you might as well go ahead and build the second story as shell space, because you're going to have to basically take apart the entire roof structure of the facility when you go vertical. So whenever you look at potential of going to a two-story facility, if that is what is desired, it's always best to go ahead and build that shell space, even if you don't finish it, now as opposed to coming back later and pulling that roof structure off. Once again, it's just throwing away money basically at that point.
I understand this. I just had to ask the question. And, you know, if this is going to take care of for the next 20 years, and we're looking at that, and even if it's only 15 years, we can't build for 100 years or 200 years. We have to build within our budget. And having said all of that, I approve the project as submitted, and enough said on it.
Mr. Jakubowski, did you have?
Oh, no. Mr. Cibula summed it up pretty nicely, but I'd like to make a motion if nobody else has any other questions to move forward.
Mr. Benton, did you have something? All right. There's a motion on the floor. Is there any more discussion? If not, we can call the question. Six yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And that, Mr. Chairman, brings us to our fire chief and his report on fire and rescue accomplishments.
It was not on enough. thank you for giving us the opportunity to speak tonight. In fact, the chairman had asked us to come back and to do a presentation following the SAFER grant. I just want to go through and kind of give an opening statement to this. Spotsylvania County has always had a good fire department, and specifically one with dedicated and capable men and women that serve both as career and volunteer fire and rescue personnel. But unfortunately, as the county expanded, the system did continue to become outdated, antiquated, insufficient for the needs of the service. One of the things that I do want to speak about is many times, because we have such a different parts of our county, from we have the congested area, we have the rural area, we have the west area, we have the east area. There's so many different, and it's such a complex system to manage. But I want to say in this case, the initial focus was that in 2010, we had about 50% of our fire and rescue stations were unmanned nights and weekends. And they were primarily in the rural areas. And many times the residents of the rural areas complain about the lack of libraries or parks or various county services. But in this case, the expansion of fire and rescue has provided service to everyone. The rural areas of Partlow, the rural areas of Broken Burg, the rural areas of Belmont, the wilderness area. But it's also expanded in areas like Salem Church to where, and just recently out to Lee Park, where there were critical shortages. If you go out on the new area where Station 11 is, that area has been under constant growth for years and never had a fire station, had shopping centers, had the largest commercial buildings in the county, no fire station. It does today. But this has been a very complex program. When I met with county admin during the agenda wrap-up, I actually had them change the title of the presentation tonight because it's not FREM's accomplishments, it's the Board of Supervisors' accomplishments dealing with fire and rescue. In fact, the Board of Supervisors came to us in 2011 and said, we want to move our fire and rescue service forward. And that was the first step by the Board of Supervisors in 2011. It was a different board, but a board in 2012 that actually came out and approved the first steps. And everything since then has been a continuation of the Board of Supervisors wanting to provide for the protection of the citizens of Spotsylvania County, both in the congested and in the rural areas of the county. And that's probably a good place to kick off our presentation. There are a number of slides. I'm going to run through the bullets fairly quickly, and then we'll certainly be open to any questions. January 2011, again, about 50% of the fire and rescue stations were without staffing on nights and weekends. And I want to say right up front, that is not a hit against the volunteers, but volunteers were being asked to provide service of a greatly increased population that just caused gaps. August 2011, 24/5 career coverage was initiated by adding single unit nighttime fire coverage at Station 2, 7 and 10, and single unit nighttime EMS coverage at Stations 3, 6, and 9. That started from something that was a county administrator's proposal to call the pilot program. And the pilot program was put together primarily by me, which they wanted additional coverage for no money. Now, any of you that run businesses on your projection, that's a hard thing to do. So what we did is we readjusted some personnel, and we came up with a pilot program, which was only to be at Station 2 and Station 10, Salem Fields and Brockenburg. And so we brought two additional people into both of those stations from other stations, which was gave us enough to start. And at 6 o'clock, we moved an ambulance from 2 over to 3 in Partlow, and we moved an ambulance from 10 over to 6 to be able to put something there at least four nights a week. And that's how we started. We had another supervisor that said, what about the other districts? And so before the pilot program started, it had to be expanded already with no additional funds or people. And we did the same thing at 7, where we had career staff on a piece of fire apparatus at 7 and moved an ambulance to Partlow at night. And that was the beginning. October 2011, weekend cross-staffing was added at Stations 3, 7, and 9, and later to Station 2 using overtime funding. Once the other began, we still continued to have large fires, specifically on the weekends, or critical EMS calls. And citizens wanted to know, where is the fire department? Where is the coverage? Why is such a delayed response? So after another large fire in Fawn Lake, we put, again, the career staffing using overtime funding to be able to cover those stations. Again, the Board of Supervisors came back and said, what do we have to do to fix this mess? And in 2011, the initial 24/7 plan was approved. In the spring of 2012, updates to the 24/7 staffing was approved and, for the first time, actually initiated by that board. Throughout 2013, initial 24/7 coverage continued to be implemented and included rescue stations 2 and 9 due to an absence of sufficient volunteer staffing in those stations. In October 2012, initial 24/7 staffing began at fire rescue stations 6 and 10 due to declining volunteer coverage. Right after November 2012, initial 24/7 staffing began at stations 3 and 7, and again, that's Partlow and Wilderness, 6 and 10 being Salem Church and Salem Fields. Winter of 2014, all station personnel were converted from 40-hour employees to 53-hour employees, reducing an annual overtime by over $800,000. Now, that's entering me as fire chief. I took a budget. We were about $500,000 in a hole. No one liked that, but we had to take all the remaining personnel that were on 40 hours, and we put them on a 53-hour work week with no additional funding. That brought the budget, equalized the budget at in end of June, made up $500,000, saved the additional expense of another $300,000, which was done, and it was not done just to save money. It was also done for parity because we had some people paid an hourly rate at 53 hours and some paid an hourly rate of 40, and it also caused morale problems that I didn't think should occur. So as the chief, my answer to it was to make everybody the same, and everybody was put on a 53-hour work week. Winter of 2014 received a 2013 SAFER grant for 9 personnel. Again, allowed us to be able to do additional work until we were able to bring on county money to do it. Summer 2014, this was the first time we actually realized 24/7 staffing. And Mr. Jakubowski, that was a question you had last time. That's when we fully realized existing 24/7 at all stations with the full complement of people that were required to fill those stations, which is 10 at day stations and 18 at the 24/7 stations. September 2016, Fire and Rescue Station 11 opens with 15 personnel, and from the adopted budget, that was a shortage of 3. We received those this current budget year, and unfortunately, we've been really having to bring in a lot of people for overtime to be able to cover those gaps, because those people, although hired, are still in the academy since we didn't get them in the last budget cycle. November 16th, though, on the 10th, unfortunately, that recruit academy graduation is your new meeting night because of the change due to the election that night, but we will graduate that group, and we will be able to put those personnel back out into the field and fill those current gaps that we have been using overtime since the opening of Station 11. March 2017, because of the SAFER grant that was received recently, again about 2 or 3 meetings ago that you approved, we will be able to put a second medic unit in service at Fire Rescue Station 6, again being Salem Church, to relieve a current 1,300 incident overage using, again, 3 personnel from that SAFER grant. Currently, Chief Cullinan had run statistics, and it shows that the high volume period for that station is from 6 to 7 p.m., so we'll be able to cover the majority of that Monday through Friday using those personnel. That will also delay the future need for another station in that area. June, August of 2012, we shift from staffing to supervision. Initially, when we went to evening and weekend work, we did not have any supervisors. And certainly anytime you have employees, it's only fair to give them proper supervision, both so there's someone to help them when there's needed help, to provide guidance, to provide training, to provide oversight. Initially, we started out with 2 battalion chiefs added to provide 24/7 career supervision, 1 per shift. We actually pulled Chief Cullinan out of the field initially, who was the EMS supervisor, and he had to take on that whole job just as a collateral function. In the summer of 2014, there was a reorganization of FREM into 2 branches, operations and support services. May 2015, reorganization of FREM into dual battalion coverage. And at that point in time, for the first time, we actually had supervisors in the northern area, which was Battalion 2, and supervisors in the southern area, which is Battalion 1, 24/7. January 2014, we initiated 24/7 EMS supervisor or incident safety officer supervision, one per shift. And that's been what I've talked to you about for the last 2 years, the importance of only having one supervisor on a time to do the RSI protocol and to provide oversight at major EMS scenes, both injuries and illnesses. But again, due to the SAFER grant, come November 2016, there'll be a reorganization of FREM into EMS supervisor ISO coverage for both Battalion 1 and 2, which will mirror the current battalion chief coverage. And again, that's being done with federal dollars for the first 2 years. EMS fire and apparatus replacement. Unfortunately, once arriving as chief and assessed the fleet, found that we had some apparatus that was so aged that the frames were broken on the apparatus. That was a dire situation. We had a lot of ambulances with extremely high mileage. We had two ladder trucks that next year, if one had not been replaced this year, we would have been able to put antique tags on them instead of municipal tags. 2013 and 14, we did the replacement of engine 3, 4, 7, and 9. Engine 15, FY15, replacement of squad 1. You may remember squad 1 was involved in an overturned accident off of Benchmark Road. And tanker 7 and engine 801. FY16, replacement of engine 10 and truck 6. FY17, replacement of engine 2 and engine 6, addition of a ladder 11 for new station 11. FY17, we moved old tanker 7, which still had some life, to fire station 5 to provide additional water, rural water capability in the Chancellor area. After several fires last year, matter of fact, we had an extremely bad fire loss last year. We lost 6 people last year. Majority of them in the rural areas. One of the biggest problems was water. We had already identified that, and help was already on the way. In fact, we've updated the tanker at the Wilderness. We've added a tanker in Thornburg, and we've moved a tanker to Chancellor, which basically provides the county with about another 6,000 gallons of water capacity in different areas of the county. FY13, 14, and 15 did the replacement of medic. This was all done in 1 year in 15, but it included funding from 13, 14, and 15, replacement of a medic 1, 3, 4, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10, replacing all of the old outdated ambulances. FY16, replacement of medic 2, 5, and the addition of medic 11 and a second unit at 6, which will be used by the SAFER personnel. FY17 replacement will be using the current allotted replacement vehicles, and the CIP will replace the 3 high mileage medic units. One of the things we also did is, for a small percentage of the cost, we've started going to four-wheel drive ambulances. Every large snowstorm, most of our engines were out of service trying to get ambulances unstuck in rural roads. The last 2 years since going to four-wheel drive units, we basically took care of that entire program with minimal, maybe 1-2 units per storm versus having to handle that on almost every call throughout the county. Public safety building had a new building put in November 2011, right after Thanksgiving, which was both for the Sheriff's Office and Fire Administration. Fire Rescue Station 5 opened August 2016, replacing Old Company 5. Fire Rescue Station 11 opened September 2016, adding additional coverage to the Lee Hill New Post area. A training center classrooms and bathrooms are set to be constructed in 18-19. And Fire Rescue Station 12 and Fire Rescue Station three replacement have been discussed, and engineering will be needed in FY 19 or 20. I'll just bring to your attention, Fire Rescue Station 3 is the only station that is not owned by the county. It is a volunteer-owned station owned by Spotsylvania Volunteer Fire Rescue, but it is totally staffed by county employees and county equipment. So they are simply allowing the county to use their building. It's an old metal building. It's been similar to what was just discussed with the animal shelter. It's been added on to and limped along for a number of years. It's got problems with the wells. It's got problems with the blacktop, problems with the concrete. My recommendation would be when Station 12 is looked at in the future to do something similar to what you just did by doing two at the same time, getting additional reductions from the contractor by being able to keep crews on two sites at the same time, by using additional work from subcontractors, by getting volume discounts like you did with Station 5 and Station 11, and potentially looking at the time, whenever that is, that Station 12 comes on board, looking at trying to replace three at the same point in time. Equipment replacement. That was an SCBA replacement. The current SCBA was approximately 10 or 12 years old. Was several years outside of the normal life expectancy of replacement. That was replaced with county funding. We purchased two SCBA air trailers. I want to say that was about a $350,000 project that was funded by the Assistance to Firefighters grant. 2016 increased ergo capability by replacing two pumpers and one ladder truck with one 100-foot quint and 275 quints. Now, I'll break that money down because sometimes I'm asked, just recently I'm asked, well, how come we spend so much on fire trucks? Can't we get a cheaper fire truck? Well, I can tell you that these fire trucks that I specified were about $300,000 more than a pumper. And we say, why in the world do you spend $300,000 more? Well, AMR, that provides the ladder company or an engine company. So you amortize that over 10 years, that's a $30,000 a year cost. You take a $50,000 employee and pay benefits at 75, and it takes four to keep three on the truck. So that's $300,000 per shift times three shifts is $900,000. You do that times 10 years, that's $9 million. I didn't have $9 million, I had $300,000, or to put it in clearer terms, $30,000 a year. You just made comments up here about a budget, staying within a budget, providing service. That's what I feel like I've done for the last 3 years as your fire chief. I provided the county with top service to protect them and the citizens, including their families, for the lowest cost possible. 2016, we also added inline Class A foam on new pumpers. That's for the safety of firefighters and to get better use of water and quicker dock down, especially in the rural areas. 2016, we received a grant for station exhaust removal system, again funded with the AFG grant, and have also going to be implementing a three-year implementation period of PPE. Both, actually all three of those last initiatives are strictly firefighter safety initiatives, and two of the largest that the nation as a whole are dealing with, second set of gear and exhaust removal program to reduce long-term and chronic exposure to cancer-causing agents. Our training center, 2012, we added an automobile fire simulator, which was built by the Korea Technical Institute, locally within the school division. 2015, we implemented an in-house ALS certification program in partnership with the Volunteer Training Center at Shannon, just down the street, and with Virginia Commonwealth University. 2016, we had a sprinkler standpipe simulator put in with a private donation at the training center, no cost to the county. 2016, a Mayday House training facility, 100% state funded. 2016, a flashover simulator, and that was just installed several weeks ago, 100% state funded. October 2016, we had some ongoing issues both structurally and cosmetic with the burn building, repaired about 90% state funded, 10% county funded. FY19, through county CIP funding, we do expect to add the classroom, restroom, and storage building at the training center. But as you can see, out of hundreds of thousands of dollars, most of it was found somewhere else where we saved county funding for other projects. Procedural implementations, and again, the first one was a big board implementation. Wanted consolidated county operating procedures for both career and volunteer. That was achieved. Minimum training and certification requirements have been achieved. Minimum staffing requirements have been achieved. Operational guidelines were put in place, and the first one was the actual ones on incident command, which followed state recommendations from the Sandy Hill fire. 2015, established automatic ladder truck response with the city of Fredericksburg. We were providing them more than we received, and we were pretty much getting the short end of the stick. We talked to them. We said, we'll help you. We need you to help us. We ended up putting a no-cost automatic ladder response in, which has served us well for about the last 2 years, both in the Route 3 and Route 1 corridors. 2016, we established a rapid sequential innovation program, which I've discussed to you many board meetings. 2016, established a FREM ALS precepting program in lieu of using the regional prototype. Fits our needs a whole lot better. Basically approved by our operational medical director. 2016, update of EMS regional protocols. In 2017, FREM will begin their long-range strategic plan. Personnel upgrades. 2014, established an ALS release stipend program. 2014, established firefighter medic career ladder program. 2015, added medic positions to the VRS hazardous duty supplement program. We went to adding medic-only positions. When we did, we found out they were not under the VRS hazardous duty supplement. VRS wanted to charge us an arm and a leg to implement that program. We went back and questioned why. They were just underfilled positions for positions we currently had. VRS rescinded, put the people under the hazardous duty supplement program at no cost to the county. 2015, brought firefighter salaries in line with deputy sheriff salaries. 2016, brought FREM captain salaries in line with sheriff lieutenant salaries. 2016, closed the gap on battalion chief salaries with sheriff's captains. 5% disparity still remains. They were all board projects that were voted on and passed and funded within the last 2 years by the very people sitting here in front of me. Future needs. I don't want to end a great program with needs, so I'm not going to make it negative, but I would say from my seat as the fire chief and from what I see, these are the future needs that need to be looked at. I can't tell you they're necessarily going to be 5 years, 10 years. Some of them I can tell you probably will be 15 years. So not saying all this needs to happen tomorrow or next year or even 5 years. But you're going to need at some point in time a fire station in the Shady Grove area, somewhere in the area of Catharpin and Pamunkey, somewhere in that intersection. There's a large number of roofs based on GIS figures that would fall in what you would call an unprotected area because of the distance. But I want to add, it's not just the distance for those houses. It's what happens when the Belmont station is out or the Brockenburg station, the long delays of getting subsequent equipment there if the primary station is not there. Or on large structure fires, the delay of getting the second due, third due, fourth due units because that area is the big circle of the county where fire protection is missing. The next consideration would be fire rescue station needs in the Massaponics Church area. I don't think I need to go into that anymore. That's the growth area. It's going to need further and probably going to be the most pressing area for you of everything here. I've never been an advocate of cross-staffing. I do believe you could get by initially with cross-staffing the Shady Grove area due to the actual low number of volume of calls that's going to be in that area, and could actually start out with less than the normal 18 personnel that we have at each of the other stations. Fire Station 6, that current district, I'm just going to call it Salem Church area, Levels Road area, to be able to handle that other growth area, which is currently 13. It's the only current station that exceeds the comprehensive plan at 1,300 calls. It's going to need additional help sometime in the future. We've already talked about the replacement of and the reason for the Partlow station. Again, the good news is it's building only. It's no people, which is your big expense. It's no apparatus, which is a fairly significant expense. Lastly, and again, I can say it is a good thing, I went to the first pay and classification meeting today that the contractors are doing. Certainly, some of the things that were mentioned today about personnel leaving and special technical ability and supply and demand of positions just in the introduction by the contractor today is certainly on the mark for fire and rescue employees. And so I think you will see in that study that something is going to need to be done with competitive pay and classification, which provides steps and COLAs. We are still losing personnel. That's probably the hardest thing for me is to see good people go. And it's just not enough financially to hold many people, and they need the money to support their families, and they're seeking it somewhere else. And I don't mean that to be doom and gloom by no means. It's just a true statement. And frankly, you have done a wonderful, outstanding job in providing better protection to our citizens. And if I had to say the one, we have done so well with stuff to protect the citizens. We've done excellent in providing stuff to protect the firefighters. The only area that I think that we are significantly behind hopefully will be addressed by the pay and classification study. And with that, that is the end. That's a lot of information, but it goes back about 6, 7 or more years. And because I was asked by you to come forward, I really wanted to cover it all and for people that are watching to really see what you have provided them. I get a lot of accolades. I hear accolades here. I hear accolades at the public safety committee at a recent meeting. Well, I say a recent several months ago at the NAACP, they said thank you for bringing fire and rescue into the 21st century. I know people appreciate it. One letter that I read to you last year said I didn't know what was going on, but you did. You knew what to do. You told my husband what to do, and then you brought me back to life. That only happens because of commitments by this board to provide that service to the county citizens. And as the face of fire and rescue, I certainly thank you for providing them that. Certainly makes my job much more pleasant and with a lot of less negative scrutiny than what may have occurred in sometimes in the past.
Are there any questions or comments from the board? Mr. Benton.
As I clamor through all my trash up here. No, I think we are, Chief, I appreciate what you've done, and for all our staff that serve every day. We have our leaps and bounds.
And I will just interrupt you just 1 second. Oh. Again, it's not about me. It's about this board, and it's about the men and women volunteer in Korea. You know, again, I'm the face, but it's really not what I've done. It's what they do every day.
It is, but somebody had to have a vision and bring forward the needs. And, you know, you and your staff have done that, and it is appreciated. I think a lot of the counties that surround us are at awe at what we've done with the fire rescue. You know, even Stafford, look at their tax rate, and they don't even come close to having a system as good as ours. Not one iota. They're not providing the services that we provide our community. And I say that as a citizen and as a firefighter. You know, I can step back and criticize myself and, you know, anything around here, but being a part of that system and seeing what we do and with our personnel, it's incredible.
You know, we have part-time instructors here that you deal with, and you know that they work many times full times for other departments. And one of them mentioned last week, he used to be an employee here years ago, but he works for another jurisdiction now and works for us part-time. But he's a resident of Spotsylvania. And he said last week, thank you for what's been done for fire rescue to protect my family.
Right, Mr. Ross.
So I know this isn't about you, but I remember when you went through the interview, and there were over 100 people that applied for your position, and you stood out. And I remember you going through on a whiteboard with the pieces of paper, your plan. You know, and it was an amazing thing to see. Chief, words can't express how grateful I am, and I think this whole board is, for what you have done. It's one thing to approve spending. It's another to actually execute it. And again, my words can't express how grateful I am for how you have executed the spending that we've authorized. So thank you from the bottom of my heart, you and your men and women.
That whiteboard cost me $25 for that interview.
Gotcha. Well worth the money.
It was worth it.
Yeah, I'm grateful you spent it.
If there are no other comments, thank you, Chief.
Thank you, and appreciate the invite again.
Mr. Chairman, if I could, before we move into closed session, which should be brief, but I don't want to lose any of the audience without having the opportunity to highlight publicly that on November 12th, we will be having from 3 to 6 p.m. over at the Merchant Square Pavilion. This is in cooperation with the W.J. Vacos companies, and our tourism folks have been planning a Veterans Day activity. Again, it'll be November 12th, a tribute to veterans, and that is from 3 to 6 p.m. over at the Courthouse Village. And there will be food, there will be speakers, including Representative Rob Whitman and others. Chairman McLaughlin's been indicated he would like to speak. Bobby Orrick will be there. The board is certainly welcome, and there will be opportunity to comment, I'm sure. There will be barbecue for veterans and their families, and there will be a variety of activities going on. More details to follow, but I wanted to at least encourage folks to save the date for November 12th from 3 to 6 p.m. over at Merchant Square. It'll be the largest veterans observance we've had. It really was born out of experience that I've had with very small events done here in the past at the memorial in front of our old courthouse, and the desire expressed by members of the American Legion Post here. I know Mr. Cibula commented on this at the time, wanting to see us do more to acknowledge our veterans. I know that that is at the heart of all of the members of the board, and in fact, we've been told by the Veterans Administration that we are the fastest growing veterans population in their Mid-Atlantic region, so it's only fitting that we should do this, and I hope to see everyone there. And with that, it's time for closed session, Carl.
This will be your resolution to adjourn into closed meeting. It's different than the one that's on your agenda. There has been one item added. Whereas the Spotsylvania County Board of Supervisors desires to adjourn into closed meeting for discussion, consideration, or interviews of prospective candidates for employment, assignment, appointment, promotion, performance, demotion, salaries, disciplining, or resignation of specific public officers, appointees, or employees of a public body, specifically the position of the Chief of Fire and Rescue. And whereas the Spotsylvania County Board of Supervisors desires to adjourn into closed meeting for discussion concerning a prospective business or industry or the expansion of an existing business or industry where no previous announcement has been made of the business or industry's interest in locating or expanding its facilities in the community, specifically a retail support products manufacturing business. And whereas the Spotsylvania County Board of Supervisors desires to adjourn into closed meeting for consultation with legal counsel and briefings by staff members or consultants pertaining to actual or probable litigation, where such consultation or briefing in an open meeting would adversely affect the negotiating or litigating posture of the public body, and consultation with legal counsel employed or retained by a public body regarding specific legal matters, specifically Walgreens Company v. County of Spotsylvania, Virginia, case numbers CL13001151 and CL15000723-00. And whereas, pursuant to Virginia Code Section 2.23711A1, 5, and 7, such discussions may occur in closed meeting. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Spotsylvania County Board of Supervisors does hereby authorize discussion of the aforestated matters.
So moved.
Call a question. Six yes.
Whereas the Spotsylvania County Board of Supervisors has convened a closed meeting on this day pursuant to an affirmative recorded vote in accordance with the provisions of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act, and whereas Section 2.23712D of the Code of Virginia requires a certification by this board that such closed meeting was conducted in conformity with Virginia law, now, therefore, be it resolved that the Spotsylvania County Board of Supervisors hereby returns to open meeting and certifies by roll call vote that to the best of each member's knowledge, only public business matters lawfully exempted from the open meeting requirements of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act and identified in the motion to convene into closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered in the closed meeting.
Mr. Benton?
Aye. Yes.
Mr. Ross?
Aye.
Mr. Cibula?
Aye.
Mr. Jakubowski?
Aye.
Have any more business?
Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Kathy, see you Friday.